Boom. We're here, boys. We're live. Welcome to the live stream. No Poker Live Podcast. My name is Joey, your 1AK Chicago Joey. I was running some lighting simulations in my hotel room here, trying to figure out which light gave me the most GTO skin reflection on my skin, on my body. Whatever, man. We got the end boss in the house today. We got Ben E6, Ben Tollerine. Ben, what's going on, Poppy? How you doing, man?
I'm good, man. Thanks for having me on. I'm looking forward to it.
Ben, we're excited to have you on. Everyone in the chat, they've been clamoring for you for months. Ever since I started the PLL podcast, people have been saying, we need Ben. We want to see Ben. Where's Ben coming from? Ben. And thank you for finally joining us, my friend.
Cool, yeah.
How's Vancouver doing, man? How are things going up there?
It's good. I got a little bored here. I've been here for like 3 years straight now, almost. And all my friends kind of came and left, and there aren't a lot of people that actually live here. It's good overall. It's full-blown summer now. It's like 70 degrees, beautiful every day. I just moved into a new place. No complaints. I'm happy here.
You've been there for 3 years straight. Have you done the visa extension process online where you just kind of fill it out every 6 months?
No, I actually applied for permanent residency. And it's been a huge pain in the ass. But as long as you're in the process, they continue to let you into the country. You're granted temporary status.
So for permanent residency, you do that online, or is that a process where you go into the office and you're doing it that way?
I hired a lawyer who Phil Galfond recommended to me. And we did the same application, everything exactly the same, and he got accepted, I got declined. I think it may have had something to do with Run It Once as being sounding like a more legitimate business than what I do. But we're appealing at a judge now, and it looks promising. I think I'll get in.
Is it something where if you don't get in, do you think it's going to matter that much? Because, I mean, I guess in theory, you could just go to a different country in Europe, or I don't know if Mexico is like a GTO option for you, but you could always go there as well, too.
I've heard good things about Mexico. I think I'd go to Sweden if I couldn't stay. Go see if Barry and Futek and Johan and those guys want to hang out with me.
Do you enjoy hanging out with people's parents?
With people's parents? No, absolutely not.
Might not like Johan or Barry. I got to be honest with you. Unless you like hanging out with people's, shout to Barry, by the way. Unless you like hanging out with people's parents. Although I guess Barry doesn't hang out with his parents too much, does he? Nah.
But
those guys they like their family a lot over there.
Really?
Well, Johan specifically. Johan still lives with his parents.
That's interesting. By choice?
Well, I think he's trying to get to $10 million US before he moves out with his parents. So right now he's only at like two or three. So he's kind of like, he doesn't feel rich enough, I think. So.
Yeah, no, that's reasonable.
Yeah, I think that's pretty reasonable. So Vancouver, you're in Vancouver, you're downtown. Obviously, I've lived in Vancouver. It's probably my favorite place I've lived. You know, what else do you do there besides play poker online? Do you have anything you like going, any hobbies? You like to go to the nude beach over there at Wreck Beach? You know, what are your go-tos?
I've only been by Wreck Beach once. I should actually check that out. I don't have any problem with nude beaches. I think it might be fun. I like to work out a lot. When Jason Kuhn was rooming with me, we spent a lot of time lifting weights and going for runs and stuff. I would say that's something I've done a bad job of actually, though, is finding things outside of poker and having dinner with poker players and stuff like that. I need to do better about that.
Yeah, I think Vancouver's kind of like an interesting spot. As you said, people come, people go. When I was there, it was kind of like the first 6 months, it was so many people were there. I was like, oh, this is fucking so cool. Like, all these people are here. There's so much to do. Then they all left, and I was like, what the fuck am I going to do now? So it is kind of like it's fun living in a different place, a different country, especially like Vancouver. But at the same time, it gets sort of like, you know, it almost gets to where you feel like you have to make new friends each time they come. Like somebody comes, you make friends, then they leave, and then you're like, well, now I got to start over sort of thing. Do you ever feel like that?
Absolutely. I'm not the type of person that values acquaintances very much. I like to be really tight with a handful of people and spend sort of a lot of time with them. You know, I like my time to myself as well. But I'm not the kind of guy that wants to have 30 friends that you have, like, you don't really know them very well. You do like small talk, simple stuff with each other. There's kind of a lot of that in this lifestyle. And so I think that's probably why I haven't made as many friends as I should, is because when I meet someone and I think, well, you know, in 2 months I'm going to this place and I'm going to be gone, especially for women, that's so hard. When you start dating someone and then you move or someone goes on vacation or something, that's a killer.
Yeah. I mean, the great, you know, a great thing about Vancouver is there's, if you live downtown, which you do, there's a lot of women to choose from. So sometimes you can like be upfront with them and say like, you know, my schedule's pretty hectic, or like, I'm going to be leaving here in a couple months. And then, you know, you kind of be upfront with them. And sometimes they're interested in you, I guess, if you let them know that's what you're looking for.
That's true. I think you filter out a lot of them, but plenty of them are fine with that. That reminds me, I want to know what you're on a Friday night and you're going out in Vancouver. What's the GTO plan for you?
All right, Adrian, I'm gonna give you three ideas.
Where do you finish?
Give you three ideas, okay? And if some of these ideas you want to do, I have a couple groups of friends there. Put you in touch with them. Maybe you guys can, you know, do whatever you got to do. It depends what you like. I got to give a shout to Adrian Phoenix. He brought his whole entire Twitch brigade over here. So this is what me and Adrian Phoenix used to do. Shout out to Adrian, by the way.
He's we came up MSNL around the same time. I played a lot of hands against AJ Phoenix.
And now you're playing some of the high stakes of PLO and AJ's. I mean, AJ, what happened, AJ? Come on, kid. Although, to be fair, you came up with a lot of people around the same time at SSNL who are retired from poker, not playing poker anymore. So, you know, it's kind of like, it's hard to get to the 200, 400 stakes. It really is. But nope. For those of you guys that don't watch AJ stream, Adrian Phoenix on Twitch, check it out, man. But yeah, so our thing to do, have you ever been to a place called The Roxy?
The Roxy. That is Jason's absolute favorite. I've been there more times than I care to remember.
So Friday night, I would probably, if I'm going to hang out with some friends, maybe me and AJ would get together. We'd go get some sushi down on Granville. We go to The Roxy. We'd have a couple beers at our normal stools. That's right by, when you walk in, the edge of the first bar, there's going to be two stools. That's me and AJ stools. I'm not taking shots at AJ in the chat. Goddamn, guys.
Like, right there in the front, or do you turn a corner?
No, we go straight in. So instead of, you don't turn the corner, it kind of blocks you off from people. So you want to be watching people as they walk in. So a DTO spot, you situate right there. You're facing towards the door. You sit there. You go dance a little bit. Maybe you talk to some people. Maybe you. Now the chat's getting sad about the AJ comment. I was kidding, for fuck's sakes. But yeah, I'd say the Roxy's a good place. If it's a date, I go to Blue Water Cafe over in Yale Town. Really great place to start. Have a couple of drinks there. Have some food. Head down to the bars, down the street over, go have some more drinks there, eventually end up, you know, going back, watching a movie at my place or something like that. I'd say those are my two go-tos on Friday night. But
okay,
are you in what capacity are you going to go out in Vancouver in, would you say, by yourself or with some other people or what?
All of it. It just depends on who's around, how I'm feeling. I'm actually not. I think a lot of people feel weird going out by themselves. I don't really care that much. I think it's fine.
It seems kind of, go to like a bar by yourself or go to or go to like a restaurant, or like what kind of place?
Go eat, sit at the bar, have a few beers, chat with the bartender or whatever, and then once you're feeling pretty good, go to whatever, any other bar that you want to. I like Yale Town. The brew pub in Yale Town's been pretty good for me for meeting new people or people being friendly to talk to that you don't already know.
So have you been out at all in Cole Harbour?
Yeah.
So there's a place, it's a bar on the street, and then you go down the stairs, they got little Jenga down there, they got a couple games that are a little bit darker. Have you been to that place?
Yeah, I have.
Those are probably my two places in Cole Harbour. My old roommate, shout out to Brad, RIP Brad, he used to go always there, hang out at that tap restaurant. He'd always go sit at the bar, have a couple drinks, talk to the bartender. And that used to be one of his favorite places to go. So I think, like, really in Vancouver, there's so many great places to go to. You really can't go wrong.
Yeah, I love places like that where you can play a game or have something like that to focus on. It doesn't seem like many people like that, though, actually.
They don't like playing the games, or what don't they like?
Playing the games, yeah.
Yeah, I think... Yeah. You got to meet some more. Yeah. Meet some more people, I guess. Cause there's definitely, I think there's a lot of guys, especially poker players that, you know, they're not as like, rah, rah, let's go to the club. Let's go to the bar. Let's go do that. Like they kind of enjoy that little low key setting of like playing a couple games or playing a board game. You play Settlers of Catan by any chance?
Yeah. I played a handful of times.
So out here in San Diego, there's been like a bunch of Settlers of Catan nights, so which has been really fun. Like I look forward to Settlers of Catan nights more than I look forward to going out to any sort of nightclub. So I'm sort of like into the board games right now. What other games do you play?
Board games or any games?
Board games, computer games, anything like that.
I play way more Dota than I should play. Dota's my guilty pleasure at the moment. I don't know, man. I've been doing it since I was a kid. I just can't help it.
Do you play with, I think, who else plays Dota a lot? I think Lex plays that a lot.
I should play with Lex. I haven't played with Lex yet. I play a lot with Jason Lavallee, or the Bikini Wax status up.
That was a constant caller up, man. Shout out to Jason. He's been on the live stream a couple times.
He's probably my number one Dota mate. some other guys that you guys don't know that I've just been friends with for a while, some live players and small stakes players.
Who usually wins between you and Jason?
We play on the same team. Oh, okay. It's a 5-on-5 game. It's like basketball. It's like basketball and chess crossed together or something. Something like that.
Basketball and chess crossed together, Ben. You just named two of my favorite pastimes. The art of chess and playing basketball. So Dota's like playing basketball and chess together?
It really is. It's a little more fast-paced than chess. And the team element of basketball, it's a 5-on-5 game. Everyone has a different role. You got your killer that starts slow, and then he's got to carry the team in the end game. Like he needs like 40 minutes to farm up all his shit and be worth anything. You got your early game bosses. You got your support players. Like when I play basketball, I'm a total support player. I just play like really solid defense. I'm kind of athletic, and I just like pass the ball. I don't ever shoot. Just pure support player. What's your role in basketball?
Well, I mean, I haven't played too much. Okay, if you want to know what's your MMR? So I don't know what MMR means, but what's your MMR?
MMR is tricky when you're old. So my MMR with the heroes that I play a lot, I think it's actually pretty high. Like my best hero is Invoker, and I think I'm probably like 4,500 Invoker. But if you put me on a hero I've never played before, I'm just dumpster tier, like 2K MMR, and my actual MMR is 3,400.
Okay, so I don't know if 3,400 is good. Some people are saying in the chat I have an 80s mom hairstyle right now. Listen, guys, I was gonna get my hair cut. I put this bandana on. I'm gonna live with my 80s hairstyle, man. Y'all tripping right now. That's awesome.
I thought you said you were cutting it off.
Well, Ben, I was gonna cut my hair off today, but I ended up engaging in a 4.5-hour conversation with a potential chess mate, and I couldn't go get my hair cut. So
why did you air quotes chess mate?
Well, when we consider chess, some other people might consider different than chess. So typically a chess for us is when we have an encounter with a potential mate. And you play chess with them. It's code. No one knows what you're talking about right now. So you're like,
Like chess and basketball, you didn't mean literal chess?
No, I didn't mean literal chess. No, I meant chess.
I'm pretty dead.
I meant podcast chess, yeah.
Podcast chess. I watch most of your shows. I don't know how I missed that one.
Yeah, that's usually something where we pop out in the live streams. During the podcast, we kind of keep it cool. We don't really get too much into it. So,
okay.
I have to tell people who are sad about Adrian in the chat that comment. Adrian's coming on the podcast next Wednesday, by the way, 4 p.m. Eastern. Hopefully, if he's awake, if I'm awake. Next Wednesday, Adrian will be on. So calm down. For fuck's sakes, man. All right, cool. Go ahead. D-Sleep says Joey's role in 5-on-5 pickup is like Steph Curry. Yeah, I'm not going to get, I actually played him and I crushed him, but I'm not going to get that carried away with my basketball ability. So okay. I don't have a role yet, unfortunately.
I did a small gamble on the NBA. There was a draft where everyone antes, I think there were 8 of us. You ante $200 and then, you have $800 to bid and there's an order. And if somebody goes all in, like say you and I both had 600 and the Clippers were up or something and you bid like 200 and then I bid 600, I just get the Clippers. You can't match my 600. So there's like position, if that makes sense. If you don't go all in, you might get trumped. And so my buddy and I decided our strat was, we didn't know what our position was going to be. So we were just going to go all in on Cleveland or GSW. And Golden State fell to us and we spent our whole 800 on them. And I think it was hugely plus EV because we basically bet 800 and it was a winner take all. So I think we bet 800 to win like 4K. And GSW is 2-1, 3-1 underdog to win from the start or something.
So why wouldn't everyone try to go for GSW or put their whole role towards GSW or Cleveland in that situation?
It takes at least a little bit of thinking and effort. It's not obvious that betting $1 on a team that nobody's bidding on is a bad idea, right? But then you could end up betting $7.99 and getting owned.
That's true. Vova in the chat. Vova Yasko must be a noob to the podcast. Welcome, my friend. He says, can you talk some poker finally? Now, I don't know if you watch many podcasts, Vova. We talk about all kinds of things, man. Life, love, the heart, some poker. If you're looking for like a strategic run at once video where Ben's going to break down three bet ranges and GTO approach from the big blind, facing an under the gun open, you came to the wrong podcast, my friend. This isn't going to be that podcast, unfortunately. But thank you for coming. If you have any questions, go ahead, ask them. Feel free. So you're not making any more training videos anymore, Ben. I see you. You were kind of doing that for a little bit of time on Deuces Cracked, right?
Lego.
Okay.
I did Lego in 2009, 2010. I think I quit around there somewhere. Yeah, those guys were really good to me when I was coming up. And actually, Aaron Chewy and Zugwad all coached me when I was an MSNL grinder. And that's how I got kind of affiliated with that group of people.
What's your outlook on coaching these days? Because I'm sure Phil's, you hang out with Phil, you're friends with Phil. I'm sure he's, you know, tried to get you to make a video once or twice for him.
Oh, yeah. they've made... The guy Mikey that runs the videos, or he manages the video guys, he hits me up every 6 months or so and just asks me the same question if I'm ready to make a video. No, not going to happen. My thoughts on coaching have always been that it's underpriced and people don't do a good job of taking advantage of it. I've had a ton of coaching through my career when I was coming up. I've never understood this. So when you're paying for coaching, what I would do is I would say, okay, I'm a 2-4 grinder. And I want to be a 5-10 grinder as soon as possible. So I'd watch the lobby every day and I'd just look at it and say, okay, well, AE Jones seems to be playing all day every day and has a good following on 2+2, seems to have big stacks every day. And then I just PM him on 2+2 and say, how much do you want to coach me? And then he would say something absurd like $400. And so you get, I have to pay 40 BBs for an hour of this guy answering any question I want. It's a total steal. So I am big on purchasing it and not big on selling it. I don't think you can sell it for a price that's worth it. I mean, you could, but I don't, people aren't, like for me to coach someone heads up PLO, I don't think anybody would want to pay what I'd ask for it. I think it would just be too much.
I mean, you might be surprised. How much would you ask for it? 1 hour of Ben 86 coaching, how much do you think, if you were going to say, yes, how much would it be?
Where they have full access to everything that I know?
Well, that's obviously going to be up to you in that situation because you kind of can choose if you want to. I mean, that's kind of up to, it's, you know, pretty much up to you in that, but.
It matters. For the spirit of the discussion, if I were to actually give everything that I have to another pro who is already quite good, like the instance that would hurt me the most, first number that pops in my head is 20K.
Now, I think there's someone that would pay that too, though, for 20K for 1 hour of coaching. I feel like there are, I'd say more than one person that'd be interested in paying that.
I'd be surprised. I think they could make it worth it if they really brought their prep with them and had all the questions lined up and that sort of thing. I'm not interested in doing that, but I'm trying to guess what I think it would be worth.
LaForte's being messaging right now. Ben, interested in 1 hour of coaching. I can see that.
I think LaForte moved to purely heads up now. I don't see him grinding much six max anymore.
Do you think that, well, obviously you've had experience with Jason Kuhn in the gym. Do you think that Jason Kuhn is the fittest man in poker, debatably, or Sean LaForte with his, dude, Sean LaForte, if you don't follow LaForte on Instagram, you gotta follow this guy on Instagram, because all he does lately, well, it depends. If you like guys who post workout videos and shirtless photos, you gotta follow LaForte on Instagram. He's going crazy lately posting those photos. But in your opinion, who would you say is the fittest man in poker?
Fittest man in poker? In terms of bodybuilding aesthetics, I can't think of anyone that's more ripped and sort of a fitness model-like than Sean. In terms of, if you wanted me to pick like my cage fight champion, I'd pick Kuhn.
Yeah, I'm a fucking Kuhn. I can't, man. So we had Jason on the podcast, for those that haven't seen it, check it out. It's awesome. We did it together when we were in Hermosa Beach over in California. He's told a lot of fighting stories on the podcast. Have you ever got a chance to witness this in action by any chance?
I think I'm very calming for Jason. I know all the fight stories, and I've never seen Jason get in a fight. Not once. I've seen some close calls. I've seen him have restraint.
He makes that. He punches his fist so hard. I've been practicing how he does it. He does it so fucking hard. It's like,
yeah, yeah. No, when he shadow boxes me, it actually scares me a little bit.
Yeah, I'd be pretty nervous too as well.
You know who else is extremely fit and drinks like no one else is Scotty Clements.
Yeah, he's a beast too.
It's amazing. He's totally ripped, and I'm pretty sure he downs like a bottle of wine every night. That's impressive to me.
And he's married too, which at some point when you get married, you kind of get less incentivized to want to work out. So,
I hope that doesn't happen. I can see how it would.
Yeah. Are you close to getting married at any point in time soon?
No, I'm quite far away from getting married.
Quite far away. Do you still keep in touch with different potential friends and so how are you about keeping up with your friends or any sort of females on social media, Facebook, Skype? Are you good at that? Do you feel like it's something that you struggle with, you could be doing better with?
I struggle for sure. It's just a trade-off. The reason I'm at where I'm at in poker is how hard I tried it and how much time I dedicated to it, and that made my social life suffer. And it's something I'm working on now. I really need a social media revamp because I don't even have an Instagram, and apparently I need that. It seems important. I need to play that game. I've resisted getting involved in all of that, and there's no denying it's important for your social life. In terms of friends back home, I have one friend that I keep up with. I didn't have many friends growing up. I was kind of a loner. I had a pretty hard time in high school and college and all that.
You feel like it sort of is a little bit easier for you now, or do you think that it's still something that you definitely could get a lot better with?
I've made a ton of progress, but it's certainly something I could continue to get better at. I have a hard time balancing poker and social life. A lot of guys do that really well, and it's impressive to me. When I play poker all day and my mind's going and I'm really trying as hard as I can, and like if anyone who plays with me regularly, I think I'm known to kind of take a little bit longer than everyone and stuff. I'm trying so hard at every moment. And I think what happens is then I go be social with someone and it's very hard for me to be present. When I'm chatting, my brain is like three sentences ahead, and it just makes me awkward. And so that's something I've got to continue working on. But I do think it's possible, and it has gotten better.
I actually think it's something that I definitely struggle with as well, is in terms of balancing it. Like, I feel like I'm one extreme or the other. And when I'm – it's almost like social life is actually a detriment to your poker ability.
It is.
And do you ever find that – has there been points where you've kind of like – social life's been starting to like really kick up and you're starting to embrace it, but you feel like your poker might be slipping and it sort of gives you that anxiety. You're like, well, fuck, man, I feel like I might not be the top of my game right now, and that's going to end up costing me potentially a lot of money.
Happens all the time. Every time I start dating a girl, I can't like date her. And like, if I go on a date and then I come home and 2-4 is running, my brain's not right for it. I got all the wrong chemicals in my brain or something to be sitting there and going to killer mode, you know?
Yeah, for sure. Especially, I mean, yeah, when it comes to like something like dating, and especially at high stakes where there's not much action that ever really runs too. But now there's been a lot of 200, 400 lately running. Shout out to Natalie Portman, by the way. But allegedly Natalie Portman. But yeah, so it's kind of, I feel like it's just super hard for a lot of high stakes guys to like, they just get so much anxiety. Like, I could be playing in a game right now. I could be getting action right now. And they sort of like can't enjoy this thing they're supposed to be doing that's fun because they're so much focused on the action that could come from something.
Yeah, it's a big opportunity cost for leaving your computer.
How do people even get better at that? Like, how are people good at sort of blocking that feeling out of their mind?
Well, you got to recognize that a balanced life is, you don't have to recognize this, it's not true for everyone, but once you decide that a balanced life is more important to you than leaving poker with the absolute highest net worth you could possibly leave poker with, then it sort of falls into place. There actually, a lot of the questions that were in the forum are sort of preference questions. I was thinking about this earlier. If you were to say what's the right amount of socializing and getting away from your computer, it depends on the person, right? Because if you're like me and you have a bit of a social life that leaves something to be desired, then the answer is going to be different than someone who's married and hasn't made as much money as I have or whatever. He's probably going to want to work harder than I am, or say he's about to have kids or something like that. That was a bit of a ramble. Actually, I forgot what the original question was.
You were kind of along the general idea. It was basically, it's just, so when I'm asking these questions and some people in the chat are like, is this the high stakes dating podcast? What is this? What are these questions about? And I got to tell you guys, this whole entire thing we're talking about now, this is why Ben is at the elite stakes, because like, you know, in a way it's like, it's sort of like a bad thing to necessarily struggle with social life. But in another way, I think it's actually what sort of helped you get to where you're at right now. Being able to almost, you know, kind of have this like almost obsession with poker to where you're all, it's just, that's what your number one priority is. That's what it sort of takes to get to the level that you're playing at. Would you agree or disagree with that?
To get to the top, barring being exceptionally brilliant, yes. It happened. If you didn't work as hard as I did and you weren't tremendously more intelligent than I was, then I probably beat you. Guys, part two is the Heads Up PLO coaching special.
What do you mean?
I'm just telling the viewers that second half of the podcast, all we do is Heads Up PLO coaching.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, guys, if you're interested in the Heads Up PLO coaching, where Ben is going to teach me about a big blind defense strategy, go ahead and skip ahead to about an hour and 10 minutes. Yeah. Sarah says, shout out to Sarah. That's my girl. She says, probably one of the realest podcast guests. Yes, Sarah DiMaggio. Obviously, she enjoys watching the She enjoys watching the podcast very much. We actually got some really good forum questions. I asked in the high stakes PLO thread, which I don't normally ask for questions necessarily from people, but I know everyone's excited to have you on, so we got a couple of really good questions. I'm actually going to go talk about Adiprin. How do you say his name? Adiprin?
I don't know that one, actually. He's Time to Gamble, right? TYG.
Is that his name? I don't know his name on Stars. I think he's Adiprin on Stars, I believe.
Yeah, he's just Adiprin on Stars.
I think he is. He says, question. This is actually a question that I feel like a lot of people ask guys that play 2550 plus only, and I'm curious what your answer is to this. He says, are you really getting enough action only playing 2550 and above? Why not take, quote unquote, easy money? Well, I put the quotes, but he didn't say that. Why not take easy money in 10-20 games when you go 3 hours without any action?
this is the preference thing I was alluding to. So for me, 10-20 is the point where it's not worth it to sit at my computer. I would value going for a workout or going to try to do whatever whatever thing I'm currently working on or something. I wrote like a note down about this. I'm just trying to find it. So for me, 10-20, it rarely feels worth it unless I'm just dying to play and try some new strat things and there's no other game running or something. 25-50, kind of a grind. And higher than that, I'm usually quite happy to be playing poker. Another thing about that question is it's frustrating to play a game where for everyone, for most of the pool, this is their main game or even a shot perhaps, and it's just absolutely game time for them. They're in the zone and they're giving everything, and I'm forcing myself to play. That's not a good situation to be in. I don't think you want to be the guy that's trying the least hard in the pool, or just the least excited to be there. And I'm still trying hard.
I think that's sort of like a, you know, it's funny because you say this, and I think a lot of people out there are gonna be like, "What is this guy talking about? Like 10-20? Like he can't get excited for 10-20?" But it's you know, do you ever feel like that when you're playing 10-20, and especially if you're having these big swings at higher stakes, it's almost like you just can't take 10-20, 20-50, sort of serious as well? Or is that something that doesn't really affect you or you think about when you're playing those games?
I think I'm good at objectively assessing my hourly and making a conscious decision that I'm going to sit here for the next 3 hours and work. I play poker for a living. One thing that I'd like to add about this, though, is in 2014 or 2013, I played like 30, 40,000 hands of 501K heads up against Victor. And it kind of, it did something to my brain with swings and adrenaline and stuff that it really stunted my ability to enjoy myself at 25-50. And it's not that I don't care about the money. It was just that every other day I would have a match against Victor at 5-1K. So doing anything other than paying attention to that seemed kind of silly.
So do you think that this is still sort of with you in your back of your mind when you're still playing now?
Yeah, because I'll play. It happened. So Victor ran up 2 million from mixed games like 2 weeks ago and dumped all of it at heads up PLO, right? And I was playing my normal Zoom and all that bullshit. And then I was so tired one night, and then Victor sat me to play heads up, and my brain, my whole body and my brain went into full focus in the zone. Like, let's do this. This is awesome. I took a caffeine pill and it was great. I was into it. I was excited to be playing, which can be rare now. And that's kind of sad.
Yeah, so you're referencing when Isildur, I did a Money in a High Stakes Poker episode about this. He made a lot of money at mixed games. He lost, I think, about 800K to Norbred, a couple hundred thousand to Sauce. And I think did you end up making like 500K or something like that? I think HSDB said.
I got six. I think Sauce got like seven, and I think Norbred got like eight. That was my counting of what happened.
That's so sick, man. Do you think, why hasn't Isildur been playing, well, I mean, you might know why he's been playing heads up PLO, but where has he been in terms of heads up PLO this year? Have you heard anything at all?
Where has he been?
Yeah, why has he been playing as much? Like, why did he decide to randomly play the end bosses at heads up PLO randomly this month?
I think he's been struggling to put a role together is all it is. He's played a lot of short PLO, the 20 BB shallow tables on Full Tilt, or the 40 BB on Stars. I think if he runs it up big enough, can't resist the greatest game on the internet, man. How could you resist it?
I mean, it definitely is the greatest game. I mean, you can win $600,000 in a couple sessions. Why wouldn't you want to play a great game like Potlove in Omaha? I completely agree with you.
What I don't get is his opponent choice. Like, I don't get why he doesn't play the five guys that would play him that aren't me and Sauce. And I suppose he did with Dorbred. That was a new match for him. But I would think there's five more guys that would take a shot. If you're sweating those games, it has to look appealing. He looks insane.
Do you think that, I mean, this is, I don't know if you can answer this question honestly, but how would you rate his play in, at the games? Would you say he's...
No, I can't rate it, honestly. He has a mode where he's rested and he's got a bankroll and he plays very well. He has it in him to play well. And then he's got this, I'm on a downswing, I'm going busto again, almost like a fuck it, I don't care kind of mode. And he plays quite bad in that mode. Although he still plays a huge standard, like a high variance style, so he can always crush you, which keeps it interesting.
So when you're playing this, do you have 100% of yourself? Is this something where you can like hit up someone and be like, hey, as like a standing, you know, I know a lot of people I know have like a standing 5, 10% with some friends, especially that sort of action, that 250, 500.
Yep. For the big stakes, I have a few situations like that where when I play, a friend has a piece. When a friend plays, I have a piece. Actually, the person I'm thinking of doesn't even play anymore at those stakes. But there's that kind of stuff going on. I was quite aggressive earlier in my career, and now I'm really satisfied with the amount of money I have, and losing a couple million would be quite a bit worse than winning a couple million. So I am a little more passive in that regard. I think I manage my bankroll pretty well. I think in PLO, the tendency is to be too aggressive because it's appealing to take a shot at a game that you're not rolled for with a stop loss, which I suppose is fine. But I would definitely say as a default, being more passive than you think you need to be in PLO is a good idea. And barring your goals, if you're 20 and you're just trying to run it up, then go for it, man.
So you find that right now, well, I guess that also might be a function of that there isn't much high stakes games that go on. So it's almost like you don't necessarily have the opportunity to play 250, 500, you know, even 200, 400. I mean, it very rarely runs. So it's not like, it's sort of like those juices aren't consistently flowing, whereas maybe if those games were running, then you would maybe be a little bit more incentivized or maybe a little bit more inclined to want to play those games and sort of embrace the variants or swings that might come with it, or I guess you might just sell more action in that situation.
I, you're right. If there were, even if there were 5,100 most days, it would make more sense to take big 250, 500, take all of it, whatever, take all of it at 250, 500, because you have a regular game that you can grind. To me, it seems like the next few years of poker, the opportunities to take seven figures out of the game every year on the internet, at least, could diminish or go away. So I don't think it makes a lot of sense to be risking that unless the value of having it, the utility of having more money means a lot to you. And I don't really think it does for me. I'm not a yacht mansion kind of dude. Or are you? What about you, Joey?
Am I a yacht mansion kind of guy?
Are you into the real high end stuff? Like would that do something for you?
Well, it's actually an interesting question you asked that, Ben. I feel like you might have been following me on Twitter and seeing what I've been doing lately, but so I've been in San Diego and I've been hanging out with some people who might enjoy this sort of lifestyle, the bottle service, the expensive clubs, the expensive looking girls, you know, with the penthouses and these all fancy places that they like to go ahead, these after parties at. And I got to tell you, man, when I was younger, when I first started making some money from poker, it was certainly nice clothes, you know, living in these nice places was something that was pretty appealing to me. But I think as I've gotten older, man, it's just like, it's certainly not something I personally strive for. It's not something that I feel like you used
to. I think I just lost you.
So much about the extravagant things that it sort of like overtakes your whole entire life and your focus and your thought process. And I feel like it's really unhealthy for me personally to have that sort of outlook or approach. So yeah, I don't think about things in terms of that way anymore. So.
It cut out a little bit there at the start, but I got the gist of what you're saying. It sounds like we're mostly on the same page about that.
Yeah, I think just being, you know, meeting people that were that way, I realized that I certainly don't like a lot of the people I've met that are that focused on those type of possessions or that type of thing. And obviously there's going to be exceptions. There are going to be some good people out there too, but you know, I guess I've ran bad in my sample size of people I've had interactions with and engaged with that it's sort of turned me off from being motivated by, you know, strictly money for that sort of reason.
Yeah, no, I feel you.
What motivates you at this point? Obviously you've got, you know, a substantial amount of money built up from poker. Where's the incentive for you to want to keep going? Like what, you know, what still motivates you? What drives you to keep playing and keep, you know, I guess it's competition or what is it?
Competition for sure. There's the element of it that I have reached the top and it doesn't make sense to. There's a lot of money out there to take right now, so it would be a kind of a silly time to quit after I've climbed so high. I love the game most of the time, but not all of the time. I enjoy making X dollars an hour. It's still nice. I'm not saying I don't like any expensive things. I like being my own boss. I've said this before, I don't want to get into it or anything, but I look at money as a resource like any other, and I'm collecting it and I'm still young. Maybe when I'm older, I'll have some great idea for it. I don't at the moment, but there can't really, if I don't have something else I'm dying to pursue, there's not much of a downside to collecting more of a resource.
Great point. Really good point. Definitely good. There might not be something right now that I want to spend money on, but you make a great point where down the road, you never know what might come up. You might want to get a house. You might start a family. You might get married to a TV actress or a TV star, you know, shout the plug up on, but yeah, you know, it could happen to you.
Oh, one sec, bud. I got to plug my laptop in or I'm going to die out.
No problem, man. We'll give a couple of shout outs. We got an interesting conversation in the chat going right now. Every time Sarah comes in the chat, one poker player always tries to engage her in a sort of chat relationship and show of force. Daniels is taking over today. Daniel, keep it up. Congratulations. He says, I'm a quality guy. Brown rice 80% of the time. Next time, if you guys are in the chat and you're thinking about want to talk to Sarah, just think about what would Lafort do. Lafort would not try to pick up a girl in chat. Okay, so channel your inner Lafort, guys. Channel your inner Lafort. This is a good question, Ben. What are you thinking about doing in life after poker? Yeah, do you have some sort of timeline for how long you think you're gonna play poker, or is it until you can't make a certain amount of money anymore, or what?
That's something I think about all the time, and I wish I had a good answer. I'm working on it. I don't know. I'm not passionate about anything yet, and I'm sure there'll be something. I think that's how it works. You don't know until all of a sudden you're doing it.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of people now you talk to in poker have this. They have a pretty good idea of. A lot of them are on the downside of their career. Like you talk to someone like Lafort. Sounds like he's thinking about, you know, things much outside of poker pretty much like these days. But it sounds like you're still in that point where you're very much poker fixated.
Somewhere in between.
Yeah. Ben asked, does Ben have a degree? How come he didn't pursue a career in that given area?
I do. I have a finance degree. And I don't think I would jump on the second money train and go do the finance thing, but it's possible. I have some contacts in finance and I think I would be good at it. I'm definitely not passionate about it. I'm not passionate about trying to go run a hedge fund or something, or I couldn't run one, go be a part of a team or yeah. I'm just not into it. That my goal would have to be to have a ridiculous lifestyle that I don't think it would be worth it. I don't think it would make me much happier than having like a pretty nice place and same thing we were talking about earlier.
Oh yeah, that makes sense. A lot of people asked about this topic, which I'm sure you've been asked many times over the years, which is about the seal. Now, I actually don't know the whole entire story on the seal, but what is the seal about? Can you lift the seal with your bicep, which you haven't actually – you didn't wear a tank top, unfortunately, in the spirit of the podcast. So people might not be able to see your arms, but you may or may not have some of the biggest arms in poker, and that might be like this little-known fact about you.
Yeah, I'm pretty thick. I'm losing weight now, intentionally. I keep getting little freezes on your end.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah, I kind of still understand what's saying, but yeah, my laptop's sort of glitching lately.
So the seal, you guys know Alex Capey? It's relevant. The player.
We know Alex Capey all right around the podcast for sure.
Is he beloved by the podcast, or
he's one of the most hated people in the podcast history.
Shit. Okay. Well, this might earn him some redemption. I was at my computer one night. I get the beep at 25:50 heads up. It's Alex Capey, and he says, "Do you want to flip?" And I said, "No." And then he goes, "I'll give you a baby seal." And I said, "Okay." So we flipped, and he won. And then he goes, "What's your address?" And I gave it to him. And then I totally forgot about it. And then 3 weeks later, I got a letter in the mail that I had a package at the airport waiting for me that weighed 13 pounds or something. And I totally forgot what it could be. I went to the airport and I opened it, and it's not real. I hope you guys all knew that it's not real, but it's this ceramic seal that I had to, there was $130 in duties on it. And it's just this ridiculous thing that no one would want. And the people were looking at me saying, "Well, you know, you can refuse it. You don't have to pay for it, and we'll just send it back." And I couldn't do that. I felt like I needed to take it. So I paid for it, and I took it. And I actually just got rid of it in the move, which is going to break a lot of hearts. I know.
You got rid of the seal, huh?
I lost you again there while you were showing your disappointment.
No, it's okay. It's okay. I think I don't know what's up. I'm gonna try changing up my setup over here to see if I can end this. Stop the free. Still freezing. But yeah, so no more seal. Where'd the seal go?
He's gone. I left him behind in the other place. I don't know where he is. I'm a bad owner.
Wait, why'd you just leave him behind? Why don't you just take him with you?
I was trying to get rid of all of the excess, and unfortunately at this point in time, my seal fell under the category of excess possessions.
Why would you get rid of it? What if the seal was bringing the run good? What if you start running bad now because of the seal?
I know, man. I don't know. I shouldn't have done that. That was not a good move.
Poor seal. Why don't you just give him away to someone? Someone would have paid a lot of money for that seal, I'm sure.
Oh, the best part of the whole story is Alex spent like $1,300 shipping me a seal across the ocean. I think that's amazing.
Well, I think that says a couple of things about Alex KP. And they're only positive things, so congratulations to Alex KP for shipping a... Do you have the seal for a couple of years?
At least a year and a half or so.
At least a year and a half or so. I'm gonna close out of my Skype, my Google Hangout real quick. I'm gonna come back in. I'll give you one question to ask and from the chat. Actually, I'm gonna ask from Adi Princess. He says, "Which regs have you battled the most with this year?"
Okay.
All right, I'll be back in a sec. Boom, 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 boom.
I assume this is still working. I'm not sure if I'm supposed to wait till Joe comes back. But I'll just answer it, and if I answer it again, I'll answer it again. I've played the most this year against a guy named Dougie Dan and Heads Up No Limit. I still play No Limit. I don't think very many people know that. And Badge Corvin. I play both of them quite a bit in No Limit. In PLO, I don't get any matches. I've played Victor. I don't think I've played any matches outside of Victor. Not like real matches. I'll get a one night. We'll play a few hundred hands or something. Ravenswood. Ravenswood's played me a little bit. There was actually a time last year where I wasn't feeling very confident in my game, and Ravenswood wanted to play me, and I didn't want to play him. But then I regained my confidence, and I wanted to play him, and he doesn't seem to want to play me anymore.
Yeah, I know Ravenswood. Ravenswood definitely he was definitely regarded as one of the best heads-up PLO players for a period of time, but I don't know if I see him playing much heads-up PLO specifically anymore.
I'm tremendously curious about Ravenswood. I want to know where he came from. I want to know how he's a nosebleed 08 player. That's kind of random. I don't know much about him. I know he's a young guy that lives in Malta. I think he's Dutch.
Yeah, I got to meet him in Vegas, him and Kobus, and he's a tall Dutch kid who's, you know, pretty nice, pretty quiet, likes to drink, likes to have fun, obviously degenerate because he loves playing high stakes 08, but yeah, he's like, you never thought it was Ravenswood. I guess a lot of people you meet, you would have never thought they were that person, but yeah, he seemed like a really cool person. He lives in Malta, I think, full time now, so if you want to meet him, you can go over to Malta, and I'm sure you guys could have some fun over there.
There's a lot of heroes in Malta. I have a question about Ravenswood. Does he have that true degen sickness that you can see like behind the eyes, kind of?
Not really, no. He doesn't necessarily even look like that big of a degen when you look at him. He just looks like a preppy... Like a preppy Dutch kid, but like he's tall and he's like, you know, he's a little bit in shape. So I'm shot. Sorry, Ravens, that might be a shot. He's in shape, but yeah. So he doesn't look like a big D-gen though.
Okay, I gotcha.
Yeah, like when you talk to him about I think he just lost like $1 million to Ivy, I believe, the week before or something like that. So he was like, yeah, I'm not gonna go play anymore 08. And then immediately when he left Vegas, I believe he was playing high stakes 08 again. So he didn't quite stick to his word on that regard.
He was definitely playing in the Izzle games, the 1K, 2K.
Do you ever think about learning 8 game as well? Because I know a lot of people now are starting to get more into 8 game. This is actually a question from Eddie Crit. Sauce, Jungle. Well, Jungle's been playing 8 game for a while. CTS is playing. Flong's been playing too.
Yeah.
Do you ever think about maybe getting into those games? Is that where most of the action is right now?
Absolutely. I'm trying. It's important. There's not much to grind at, so it's pretty much work by hand and try to figure it out, and then that's a pretty big barrier when you can't go play and practice and learn from other players and stuff like that. I'm not going to jump in at 1500 3k to see if I'm any good.
Well, I know a lot of 2550 runs too. Do you ever think about playing those stakes as well?
Yeah, does that run? Like ring game?
2550 8 game. It seems like when I check the lobby, it seems like 2550 seems to be running, I guess, decently enough.
Mm-hmm. I put the most effort into deuce. My studs are pretty bad. My limit hold'em, I'll just go copy the Cepheus spot. What else? 08, I feel like I might be okay at, just because I'm... Nah, that's not relevant. Never mind. That my PLO skills will not help me in 08.
You get four cards. I mean, how different can it be, right?
Pretty much, yeah. I can't lose at the high variant.
In theory, right? It seems like it'd be not a light up here. Let's see this? See those? How's this the lighting in here? Yeah, I guess that. I just have this like shadow on me. I've been studying some light simulation traveling, but. Ikaxin hasn't released his dream machine yet to the world, so unfortunately. Do you ever talk with Ike or ever talk with Phil about strategy or any sort of mixed game strategy? I know Phil was getting into mixed games for a while.
A little bit. We don't really. It's weird, as we're all friendly and we all like each other and we hang out when we're in the same city and stuff, but we still play against each other, so we kind of keep the the other part separate. That's kind of a weird thing about high stakes poker friendships, is you can like someone and have that competitive animosity at the same time. I find that hard to manage sometimes.
In terms of how so?
You play against someone all day and you're competing and trying your hardest to beat them and dealing with all the things that PLO does to you during a day. And then you go get dinner with them and you've got to bring the, you've got to put all that aside and go be friends with each other and know that the other part was just business.
So do you almost think it might be better for you to meet people that either don't play poker one or potentially play a different game than you completely? So that way you can, those two things don't intersect or interact at all with each other.
Friends outside of pokers would be a great idea. Yeah, I think that would be most important.
Do you ever find that in Vancouver, you actually have, I guess, you know, you probably aren't meeting many people outside of poker who you feel like you would be friends with, especially living in a foreign country in a different city where you aren't even sure how long you're going to stay for. It's probably something that almost might be, you might just be hesitant to even try altogether.
Right. It's hard, yeah. Like we were chatting about at the beginning, if I'm going to invest some time into someone, I'd like to know that we're actually going to have a chance to become true friends with each other. And that's often not the case with the impermanence of what we do and being out of the country and whatnot. It's hard.
So do you ever think about coming back to the States then? Or is that something you haven't considered then? You know, it's like you want poker, but at the same time you want this friendship as well. And, you know, when do you potentially sacrifice one for the other one?
I think you have to work on the balance. I don't think you want to be sacrificing. Like I've pretty well sacrificed. I never see my family. I don't think that's good. I'd like to do better about that and see them more. I believe a balance is possible. I think it's very challenging. I think you can have it all. I really do. But I think it takes a lot of effort and the same skill we're talking about with when you go on a date and then you go play nosebleeds, that ability to switch gears, I think is a skill that you can develop. And I think it's important for what we do to be able to balance all the different things that you want to be taking care of in your life.
Yeah, I wonder if there's like a training site for that, because that's, like I said, that's something I need to learn. I think it's like a, yeah, man. But you know, I think you find that a lot of the people that have that balance never really have a lot of success at poker. They just don't become successful at poker, because especially in today's climate, it's just so hard to really be one of the best when you're going on a couple, like sometimes you just hang out with friends for 2 or 3 weeks and you just take 3 weeks off and you're not thinking about poker for 3 weeks, and then to jump back in. I think some of the guys at the highest stakes at the elite levels can do that, but yeah, I don't know. I don't think that's like a, I think a lot of those people that I knew that used to be good at that aren't playing poker for a living anymore.
I agree. There's very few examples of people who have been able to balance a high level of nosebleed poker play, good family life, good social life, good take care of the body, that sort of thing. I really do think it's possible, though. There's no finite barrier that I can't cross when I, to use the date example again, the only thing that's actually going on there is my, whatever's going on in my brain is not suitable for being on a date. And then when I'm done with the date, it's not suitable for playing nosebleed poker. But I don't believe that it's something that I have no say in. I think it's something you can work on and learn to control. And that's what I'm working on. I don't know, man. Maybe I'll be the guy that does it.
feel like you're sometimes trapped in Canada, if that makes sense.
Absolutely. Who asked that question? That's a, feel like we're in the same struggle with that.
Why do you feel trapped in Canada?
Because if you leave Canada, you don't know if they'll let you back in, and it takes a 2-hour border interrogation every time. It's brutal.
The main reason why I didn't leave Canada for a year is because I felt like I was trapped in Canada. I was like, God, like if I leave here, I got my car here, I might not get back in. What happens to my car? I'm not going to be able to play on Poker Stars. Like, I was like, what am I going to do with my life? And that like gave me so much anxiety and stress for like the last 2 months I was there. So finally I was like, I got to get the fuck out of here. It's just driving me fucking crazy. And like, it's a weird thing to say you're feel trapped. And a lot of people I know go back and forth plenty. Like, I think Phil travels a lot. I think Jason Kuhn travels a lot too. Mm-hmm. But I've never quite like just, I don't know, I guess you're always the same way because you never left. So you must be feeling the same type of thing I do. You see these other people, you know, they do it. They can leave. They come back.
Yeah.
You know, why don't you, it's just something that you don't want to deal with. You just don't want to take the risk of it happening, because if it does, then you're just like, you know, what the fuck am I going to do now? Sort of thing.
It's a little bit of the risk. A lot of it's that I enjoy traveling less than other people do. I don't care for going to EPT stops, and I don't like the World Series either, so those things aren't a big deal. There was another aspect of that I had a comment about, and I forgot. Oh, it's the border thing. I think someone like Jason, very charismatic guy, comes to the border, and they treat him like a genuine, or what were you going to say?
No, I was going to say anything. I was just like, yeah, he's kind of, you know, pretty charismatic guy.
When I get there, I don't want to fuck it up, and it kind of makes me anxious. So I have my return flight info, and I have my, like my bank account, whatever, all the things they say that you're supposed to bring. I do that because I want it to go smoothly. And I think that actually makes you look like a drug dealer. So I think if you showed up and you were more relaxed about it, and they would probably not bother me as much. Just a side note on that, I suppose.
Well, I actually have a story relates to that. It's freezing. I'm getting tilted by the freezing. But okay, so when I last left Vancouver, it keeps freezing, doesn't it, Ben?
It is, yeah.
Yeah. All right. Let me see if I can switch browsers here. I'm buying a new laptop, guys. I'm never doing a podcast where it freezes again, because it was doing this sort of last time, and I was trying to figure out a way to not let it happen again, because it's one of the most tilting things I've ever done in my life is having this freeze.
Will you link me to YouTube on if you want to like restart your thing, if you link me to the YouTube, I'll just answer chat questions and screw around with people in chat. If that would help you out.
Let me just try it on here. I'm going to try it on the Internet Explorer here and see what happens. The old Internet Explorer, the craziness of the chat here, of the craziness of the world. Oh, here we are. All right. It just works. Bada bing, bada boom, bada bam. Boom. Switch it up. Let's see how it works over here. Mer, I guess we'll figure it out. Do you have the chat open still? I closed the chat out because I thought that might be hindering my my progress on things.
Yeah, I got it open.
Is the chat open? You can feel free if you see any questions in there right now, because I closed it out. If you see any good questions over time that you might want to, we can talk about.
Okay. Is there a lag on the chat or no?
There's usually like a 15-second lag on the chat.
All right.
Yeah, I'm hoping this will work. I was going to go to the store today and buy a laptop, and I tested it out earlier, and I'm like, it's working fine, but now it's just, now it's, YouTube's not paying me enough to buy a new laptop, guys, come on, man. Okay, so I think it might be good. So I'm going to tell the story. So when I left Vancouver last time, I went to the airport, I was going to Australia, I was wearing like sweatpants and like a hoodie, and I was kind of dressed like a bum. I bought a first class ticket, it was $7,800, I paid for it in cash. So as I was walking through the security, they were like seven mean-looking people staring at me. I was like, they're looking at me. This is weird. So once I get past there, they take me to the side and they say, sir, can we go a word with you? I'm like, yeah, sure, let's have a word. They're like, do you know what we do here? I'm like, I'm not sure. He's like, what do you think we do? I'm like, I don't know, drugs, guns, something else. He's like, you notice how you said drugs first? I'm like, yeah. He's like, yeah, we're a specialized drug enforcement agency to catch drug smugglers. And I was like, oh, fuck, I'm not a drug smuggler, but I may or may not have been engaging in some illegal substances previous 2 weeks, which, you know, my bad, it shouldn't. So they took me to the side, and they interrogated me. They looked me up. They searched me for 2.5 hours. I got to the airport really early to buy my ticket. They searched through all my bags. They asked me all these questions. They tried seeing if I was smuggling drugs in my stomach, took down a bunch of information, and then I got to go on the plane with like 15 minutes to spare. But ever since that point, I've been very nervous to return to Canada, because I'm pretty sure, like, what if they wrote that down and I can't get in? You know, I'm not quite sure if what's going to happen with that. But I wasn't smuggling any drugs, luckily, and I made it okay to Australia, so, yeah.
How did they go about deciding if you had drugs in your stomach or not? That sounds invasive.
I think they just kind of went off the answers of my question. They're like, we think you might be, they're like, do you know what would happen if you got, if you had a cocaine bag explode in your stomach? And oh. I was like, what are you talking about? Like, I'm not smuggling drugs in my stomach. I was like, are you guys fucking serious? I was like, are you guys just kidding around? They searched my phones. They're looking at the pictures in there. There's yeah. some pictures that might be a little scandalous in nature by maybe me or by other people. And it's just like, I was like, man, I'm never coming to Canada again. I haven't come to Canada since then, man. So that's, yeah, I don't, that's the, yeah.
Here's a decent question over here. It says, how much money would you need to play 501k heads up against Izzle to have a legit bankroll for it? I'm going to say, I assume he's talking about full stack. I would say you need 200 buy-ins if you're taking all of it and locked into a bunch of hands or something. But if you're taking a shot, then all the rules change.
200 bucks. What the? That's a lot of money. You got 200 buy-ins? I guess you could always sell action for those stakes. I'm sure people would buy action for you at pretty much any stake anytime.
Yeah, I was trying to answer a reasonable role for that standard deviation that Isildur brings to the table. You're right. This is distracting. I'll try not to look at it too much.
I know it's I've kind of gotten good at looking at both of them, but so guys, if you're asking any questions, I turned the chat off. Unfortunately, I do apologize. I might turn the chat on back towards the end of things, and you can ask a couple questions then. Shout out to everybody in the chat right now. Shout out to everybody watching this back on replay. If you're watching this on iTunes, that's weird. I have probably haven't put it up yet. So, yeah, kind of is what it is.
So. The first thing I saw when I looked over at it is it goes, some guy wrote, Ben doesn't want to see the chat, LOL. And that totally piqued my curiosity. I couldn't stop looking at it.
You get some great comments. Luckily, we've kind of moderated the chat around here where it's usually a positive chat. Unfortunately, sometimes when Kim Jong's not around to strike down the banhammer J-Kun style, the chat gets out of hand. So we try to regulate our community quite strictly, just like Kim Jong would in North Korea.
I've always wanted to be a moderator for a chat or a forum. Never had it.
Would you be a strict moderator, or would you be a lenient moderator who let people...
I'd be absolute justice hammer.
Why? What would you be a justice hammer for?
Because unmoderated chat is the absolute pits of the internet.
What do you think about the high-stakes PLO chat on 2+2?
Just the general forum there?
The general forum, the discussion that goes on in BBV, the discussion that sometimes goes on in the LC thread, which doesn't really happen much anymore.
BBV thread's fun. It's fine. The forum otherwise kind of bothers me because there's, I'd say, about 30% trolling and 70% genuine people talking about stuff. And some of the troll accounts on there just blow me away how dedicated they are to their craft. It's actually impressive.
About Benny specifically, who I hate to even say his name and give him any sort of anything, but he really, his trolling, like, honestly, I posted it, it was impressive. Like, I feel like if he applied his trolling to actually getting good at PLO, he'd only be a -5 BB per 100 winner instead of, or a -5 BP per 100 loser instead of a -25 to -30 BB per 100 loser, which I think he is right now. So
I want to know more about him. I want to know what the rest of life looks like if you have that much dedication to that persona that he's writing. But we shouldn't. This is what he wants, Joe. We can't derail to Benny.
God, I know. God, but he's just, yeah. But speaking about the thread, the forum in general, I feel like if it was more, because we're on the term of moderating, I feel like if it was a little bit better moderated, the discussion that you see is going to be a little bit higher quality. I feel like back in the day on 2+2 in the high stakes thread, you saw these higher quality discussions because the people discussing were regulars in the games who actually were talking about relevant things to what other people want to discuss. And now what you're finding on that specific forum is that a lot of the discussion is, you know, from these like trolls, it just makes the discussion bad for everybody around. And I feel like it needs to be a little bit higher moderated, because obviously you're hearing a guy like you say, you know, echo the same sentiments that I think a lot of other people share as well.
Yeah. The time for that's passed, honestly. There's not a medium in which people are going to share high-stakes PLO advice for free anymore, so I'm not sure there's much value in moderating it. You have to just kind of find the threads that you know are the purest and stay there and get out, stay out of the rest of that shit.
What do you think about guys like Phil and, I guess only Phil, really. Like, guys like Phil still making these 25, 50, 5100 PLO videos on Run at Once.
I think the video makers are kind of insane. Frankly, I think the video makers are insane. I don't think you can compensate actually playing your best on video at high stakes PLO for the amount that Run at Once is going to pay you. That said, I'm all for it's a fair business. We're all trying to make money, and if you like the variance free money of filming yourself playing and distributing that, then good for you. I don't see it. I don't think it's worth it. And then, I mean, Phil's killing it. And, like, I don't know how he's doing financially, but if you're gonna be in that business, be the guy that's the CEO selling all the shit. That's the way to do it. You want to be the CEO, not the doorman.
Yeah, I think that's why Phil, you know, had his experiences at Blue Fire. He had his experiences there, and they didn't seem like they ended on the highest note. And obviously now he's decided to, you know, be the guy owning the building. And I guess that's why he's still incentivized to put out these 25, 50 videos, which I think are really great quality, by the way. And you know, I think it's insane to do the videos too. But it seems like Phil's been having some good results as of this year too. So. Seems like it's been paying off for him pretty well.
There's two additions to that. One is Phil spends a lot of time in the U.S., so he gets to have work to do while he's abroad, which is important and makes it such that it makes more sense. And two, Phil doesn't teach a style that is easy to mimic. He doesn't teach... I don't watch videos anymore, but he doesn't teach a theoretical formula that you can learn and follow. Phil thinks through spots with his gigantic brain that he has and then makes a decision. And I don't think that's easy to mimic. I think he gives less than someone like me would.
Interesting. Do you have a Phil Galfond impression you can give us?
A Phil Galfond impression? Okay, I'll give it a shot. Hey guys, this is Phil Galfond for BlueFirePoker.com, and today I'm going to be playing four tables of 25-50 Deep Annie PLO. That's all I got. I don't know what he says. Was my hey guys good at least?
I thought it was pretty good. He's like, hey guys, I watched, honestly, like, I swear to God, I've watched so many Phil Galfond's videos. Like, I go to sleep Well, I started going to sleep to some of the Nolan tournament videos because those things put me out like in fucking seconds. But I've fallen asleep many to a Phil Galfond video in my time, and it's just, he's got that very peaceful voice that just makes you want to go to bed.
I think he serenades mini poker players before bed, not before bedtime. I think that's a very popular way to fall asleep.
Do you have like a go-to method of choice to fall asleep, or do you kind of just, can you just crash pretty well? Do you have like a fan? Are you like putting on classical music? Classical music.
I actually have a bit of, I wouldn't call it insomnia, but I'm having an impossible time sleeping right now. So no, I don't have a good sleeping strategy.
Okay, couple questions on that. Do you sleep with an eye mask?
I don't, but I think I might have to in my new place. The windows face a direction that lets quite a bit of light in. You know the things about that, like people that sleep with an eye mask or earplugs or something, do they do that with like a girlfriend? That just seems so weird to me.
Well, Ben, I'm glad you asked that question. I may or may not have engaged in a couple sleeping sessions with someone who enjoyed wearing an eye mask, and they wore the eye mask when they slept together with me. Yeah.
So I guess it's not that weird. It strikes me as weird.
Why do you think that's weird? Just like, just put the, it's, maybe I have mine actually. Hold on. I've been using it. It's really helpful. Oh, I've been using it as a headband lately. I forgot. My hair's gotten too goddamn long. I couldn't find it. Yeah, it's like you just.
Yeah. I'm coming around on it. The amount of weirdness I associate with it's going down rapidly.
Maybe we should try doing a little bit of the podcast with me wearing the eye mask on. See if we can get you a little more comfortable with the eye mask.
You know, the weird one is the retainer. I can't imagine sleeping with a retainer in my mouth with a girl also in the bed. That sounds awful.
How would you kiss the girl? That sounds like it'd be pretty hard to do.
Yeah. Retainers are like the least flattering, one of the least flattering things you can have on your person.
I don't know about this head mask, man. Dude, this head mask is so sick. I swear to God, I wish I started wearing one like 5 years earlier. Although I keep my place pretty dark, but a lot of the places you rent in Vancouver, they don't have the best, like they put these like noob curtains in that let sunlight in. It just makes absolutely no sense at all.
I know, man. I'm part of that right now. I got to figure that out.
You might need to do a little bit of custom work done where you take a little bit of that upswing money and invest in some like temporary, like ask your landlord if you could put like black, some sort of blackout something in there. Like, I'll pay for it. Just let me like put them in here, please. I promise it's better to have these white ones.
For sure. You know, the other thing I want to blow some money on is I want to be able to play poker without sitting in a chair. And I don't want to be standing either. I want to be able to like kind of lie down a little bit or like lie back and like suspend some monitors or something. My back is really screwed up. And it sounds silly, but I actually think it would go a long way to alleviating back pain to not be sitting in a chair for 10 hours a day.
Well, I have a couple other sleeping strategies I'm going to give to you. Do you ever use a fan?
No. Is that helpful?
Super helpful. My ex-girlfriend started bringing a fan over. She's like, I have to sleep with a fan. Sleeping with a fan, just like the white noise sort of like blocks out. I don't know. It's helped me so much. A fan, sometimes I put on rain sound through my iPhone. So I set the rain. I use Rainy Mood. It's a Rainy Mood app you can get, or you can go to the website rainymood.com. And you put the rain and the thunder on. That helps me too when I really can't sleep. The extreme of sleeping pills, not something I recommend to people because they are something that you could potentially get addicted to, even though they allege that you can't get addicted to them. Mm. But those are, like, I would try a fan, a mask. I would try, if you can't sleep with headphones, and sometimes I like putting noise-canceling headphones on and then putting some rain on my ear. That passes me out every single time. But, yeah, those take some getting used to, though.
The white noise, I think, would definitely help. I think that's a good idea.
You can try it for your back. Obviously, my number one go-to is the foam roller. Do you use a foam roller?
I know I should. It's one of those things that I know is good for me, and I don't ever do it. It's right up there with stretching.
Foam rollers, man. Full. Obviously, if you're working out a lot like you are, you're trying to get the arms a nice GTO size. You're obviously pushing a lot of weight. The stretching's huge. I mean, I think I'm sure Jason's probably talked about the stretching, the foam rolling. I actually visited a chiropractor because I play so much basketball, and I went to 3 sessions with the chiropractor. He did some crazy things to my back. He showed me 2 or 3 stretches that really helped strengthen the lower back. And ever since then, I've had basically no lower back pain at all. And I used to have a lot of lower back pain too.
Are they stretches or exercises?
Stretches. So what he did, he did a couple adjustments to me, which helped a ton. Showed me a couple stretches I did all the time. I started using the foam roller. I started doing yoga. I started clenching in my abs as I was doing my workouts and playing basketball more, which I wasn't doing before. So I was putting less strain on my lower back and putting it more on my abs. And yeah, I mean, I haven't had much lower back pain pretty much since that point, which has been about 10 months. And I play basketball, you know, all the time still.
You should give me those stretches when we're done or whatever. I'd be happy to add those to what I'm currently doing. Nothing's really worked for me, man. Low back is tricky.
Lower back is tricky. Obviously, the bed matters a ton too. But I'm sure you probably have like a. Do you have a place furnished, or did you bring your own furnishings over?
My buddy left all of his stuff in here. He's got really nice stuff, but sleeping in a new bed takes a little bit of time to get used to.
For sure. Do you use a body pillow when you sleep?
No.
You're missing out on all the good ideas. I mean, I tried everything to fix my back before, and I definitely fixed it. I use a body pillow, so I kind of like pretend it's a person and kind of like just like lay on the body pillow and like sleep on my stomach on the body pillow, and that helps a lot with the back too. So, but we're giving a couple of good hacks out there to people who have these problems, because I know a lot of people have similar issues with, you know, all types of things like this. Dorbred asked a great question. He says squat/deadlift/bench/OHP.
What was the last one?
OHP.
OHB with a B as in Ben?
I don't know what he's talking about. I guess he's talking about your maxes in squat, deadlifting, and benching, and then something that's OHP.
I don't know what that last one is. I want to say it's overhead press, but I can't. I don't know. I'm real injured right now. I don't power lift anymore. At least I'm trying to get healthy. I capped out at some pretty nice numbers though. My all-time best bench was I hit either 315 or 325 when Kuhn was trying to turn me into a silverback. For squat, I was far off overhead press. Okay, yeah. Squat, I was not as strong. I have short legs and a longer torso, which is really harsh on your back when you're squatting heavy. And my best squat was like 275, and I never did one rep maxes on squats. I did 275 by like 6 or something. Overhead press, I never maxed out on. I never was very good at deadlifting either. I never tried for a deadlift max. In Texas, in public school, they had this really shitty weight routine where we would do chest, we would do bench, incline, and squats. So my chest got extremely strong because I was lifting that like 3 years before I was even trying to work out. And so yeah, I just got like pretty far ahead on chest, and it's not good for you to overdevelop certain parts. And it causes all these weird tightness imbalances and stuff. Like my shoulders pull forward because of how tight my and how big and tight my chest is.
Is that a posture related thing too? Is your posture pretty good?
My posture is okay. It's gotten a lot better. I think that's very important for the back pain, like you were saying with the core muscles and engaging that. And
well, I guess it might be interesting. I actually started working on my posture a lot. I'll teach people a quick hack out there too. So I was having big problems like with the back pretty much around the same time, and my posture was one big thing. So I read this thing. It's basically like you push your shoulders back. So it's kind of like you stand up. You pretend you're like your mouth's like hanging from something. So you're like this, whatever, I can't get it in the picture, but you put, you push your, you roll your shoulders back and you like pretend your mouth's hanging for something. So your shoulders are back and then you're, so now you're standing up straight like this and your chin's up in that. And not only does it give you better posture, but it actually makes you an overall more attractive person when you're walking around, because you, you're standing up, you're not slouched, you're, you look more confident, you're kind of walking with some sort of, I don't exactly know what the fucking, what that, why it does that, but that's what they say. So that's kind of,
I get what you're saying. That stuff's important. It's just difficult.
Yeah, it's really hard to, like, really takes a lot of, like, focus to change. I mean, I catch myself all the time just, like, slouching, and so I'm always trying to, like, even during now, I'm trying to, like, make sure I'm sitting up straight and have the shoulders back and kind of just...
Yeah. And especially for walking, because part of what you said there was it's a more confident look. But if you're not used to walking like that and you're kind of trying to like hold your chin up and your shoulders back, you might look more awkward than the way you normally walk. It's not a,
counterproductive. Like,
you can't just learn it overnight. You have to, these things are skills that you have to learn.
Yeah, you gotta put a, you definitely gotta put a little time in the lab, as Patouche would say, and gotta grind it out a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
You're not going to Vegas, you already said, correct?
I might go for that week that has a 100K one drop, 25K PLO, and main event or something like that. That's a pretty decent week to go.
The 4-day 25K event, the 100K one drop, the main event. That's going to be, yeah, I think that's 25K is 27th, I believe. 28th, 27th. 4 fucking days of full ring PLO tournament. That sounds like it'd be fun.
It's so brutal that they don't come around on removing full ring PLO. It just shouldn't be a thing. Stars did it for Scoop. There's no full ring PLO tournaments this year. It's all six max.
And thank God for that. Yeah, I don't understand how the Scoop can have a better six max tournament. Well, I guess, so they get the 5203 stack, which I love. It seems like that's such a great format to do it. Obviously, they took that from WSOP, which did that initially. But now the WSOP changed it to a 3K six max, which on the one hand, it lets more people play, but on the other hand, it kind of, I don't know.
The WSOP dropped the buy-in to 3K for the six max?
Yeah, so it's been 5K for the past couple of years, and now it's 3K this year. And that's the only six max event for PLO is going to be a 3K now.
Yeah, it's a shame. It's not the worst change, but it's a, yeah, it's a shame. That 5K was a good tournament.
Yeah, but I guess it gives more fun tournament players a chance to play the play the six max, which I guess in theory might increase the EV for some of the better PLO players.
No, I think the 5K is going to be higher EV. I actually don't think the drop from 5 to 3K adds that many players.
I would assume that's why they decided to make the drop, was because maybe they felt like the turnout wasn't high enough for the 5K. So it's actually, I'll be interested to see what the change is.
I will too. Yeah, you're probably right. I don't know anything about it. It doesn't strike me as that much of a price point change to, we'll see.
I guess when you have like 1500 and 1000 WSOP events, 5K, you know, that's like this like, oh fuck, 5K, okay. But 3K, I think a lot of people can justify it. Like, oh, it's, I can put it on my package. It's only $1,500. It's six max. I'm a six max player. I'm good at poker. I'm good at tournaments. Like, of course I'm good at PLO. It's six max. Like, if I can play that. So, you know, hopefully that might be what happens for some people.
Yeah, I know. Live poker is full-blown magic. Games form live that never happen online constantly. Just pure magic.
Yeah, do you ever think about playing more live poker, playing any live poker at all?
Live poker makes me unhappy, man. I hate it. I hate the politics. I hate the personalities. I hate how slow people play and stare at you. Not my thing.
Do you ever feel like if online poker starts to fade away that you would start playing more live poker? Or do you feel like you'd play something else or you'd do something else in your time before you'd get into live poker?
I'd do something. I don't have it in me to... That kind of grimy wild poker hustle that you need to play in nosebleed games is not a skill of mine. Actually, not a skill I even want to have. I don't think I could do it.
Yeah, the griminess needed is sort of it's pretty it seems pretty savage, especially when you start getting into the private games and people, you know, playing on credit, not getting paid, having to deal with not getting paid in situations like it's just, it seems like it's a lot of side antics that happen in those sort of settings.
For sure.
So. Badger asked a good question. Shout out to Badger. He said, what's your reaction when Ilari Finn sits at your 200-400 table at 4 a.m. Sunday morning?
That's a good question. Yeah. So there's two parts to that. The part that makes me happy is that I love beating Ilari. Ilari money is up there for my favorite money of all the money. The other part of that is that Ilari actually plays quite well when he's drunk, so it's not like playing Ilari at 4 a.m. finish time on a Sunday is not all that different than playing Ilari at any other time. I think he's unbelievably well-functioning when he's shit-faced.
And Badger's second question was, what I've heard and seen, other top Omaha regs describe your play style as batty, aggressive, and hard to play against. Okay, that's an interesting question. Where do you think other people go wrong when they try to copy your style and usually end up spewing too much?
Yeah,
great question, Badger.
It's a good question. I don't have a problem with that question.
I like the question. I'm just curious to see what your answer would be to that question.
I have a few notes on that. Most importantly, I think it's hard to implement a strategy that you don't understand. So if you see stats or something, or you see one hand turned over, that's not enough for you to mimic what I'm doing. So that's a starting point for how that could be a problem. If you actually sit there and use theory and think about it and really try to break it down, I think it could be quite helpful. I had a few more things to say about it, but I'm not sure that they add much value to the answer. And I think a big part of it is how much I have so much experience playing this game. I switched over basically right when it got popular, so it's also going to be hard to differentiate when I did something exploitively because I was pretty sure what was going on at the moment, and it might not actually be part of my game plan. I think that can screw. Like you can get sort of bad evidence, for lack of a better word. You can get a hand that I played weird on purpose and then not know what the fuck's going on and misapply what I did. And also, just the stats are misleading. You can, if you were trying to, one of my friends I have a lot of respect for told me he was trying to get his check raise out of the big blind up to where mine was, and you can't just go after the frequency if you don't know how I'm compiling hands to reach the frequency. The frequency doesn't really tell you much at all. Well, it tells you something, but it's not good enough. So I think there's plenty of ways to screw up mimicry.
I like that answer. Thank you very much, Ben, for answering that question. Thanks for the question, Badger, by the way. Shout out to Badger, man. Keep up the great
questions. Those were good.
I like that one. Shane Stewart asks, at what point is it no longer worth it for you to sit around all day hoping to get action? Do you sit glued to the computer when Isildur is on a heater? Probably.
Yes. Yes, I do. I run some crazy hours. I ran some crazy hours when Victor was beating everybody at Mix, and actually the only reason I got to play him is his pecking order was Dorbred, then Sauce, then me. And the only reason I got to play him is I was up at 2 a.m. West Coast time and Dorbred and Sauce were not, and I got a session out of that. The 2550 thing we touched on earlier, so I don't want to reiterate that conversation. It comes down to your preference. How much do you want the money, and what else do you have going on that's important to you? That's basically what it comes down to.
Did you follow the Claudico matches at all? thoughts on that. What do you think of the capability to approach PLO? It's actually something I've been wondering too. Would you be interested in partaking in something similar where if there was a PLO bot like the Evil Empire did where they played them, would you be interested in doing that? If they gave you some 100K incentive similar to what they got?
I'd play a PLO bot privately. I wouldn't play it on webcam in a public setting like that. I followed the matches a little bit, not very much, to be honest. I don't know if they beat it by tricking it. I know there was a lot of like call and open and then min bet, and I was under the impression that that confused it, and its response to that was really shitty. So if they beat it by tricking it, that's much different than if both players were allotted specific bet size buttons in each scenario, and then they choose which button to press. It would be much more impressive to me if they had the same options at every action point and then beat it. I don't know enough about the challenge if they beat it in more of a pure way, or if they beat it by sort of just tricking it and messing with its abstraction or whatever the proper term is.
That's an interesting question. I'm actually going to have Doug on a podcast sometime very soon, so I'm going to ask him that question and kind of see what his answer was, because I think that does matter to the – yeah, I mean, even then, they didn't really beat it by much, and I guess a lot of the discussion in the NBG is that, you know, like, it seems kind of scary to that there is a bot that could be, you know, beating potentially at a 25-50 level. Like, he could be winning at a 25-50 level online. And a lot of people seem that, you know, I feel like that's kind of a worrisome thing in terms of, you know, what could happen, what the future could be in terms of, you know, that sort of thing.
I agree fully. I think heads up NL is a dying art for sure. There was a question following that if I was concerned about PLO facing the same problem. Mm-hmm. And you mind if I address that one?
Go ahead.
I think we're actually safe. I think PLO has the wonderful thing going for it that is 200,000 times starting combos, because my understanding of what those AI bots, whatever you want to call them, what they do is they create a strategy for every hand that you could have, and I don't think grouping or bucketing or grouping hands is good enough in PLO. I don't think you can shortcut and say, I'm going to play my top set this way X percent of the time, because all four of your cards matter too much. Like, top set with these blockers should be played differently than top set with those blockers. So I think the fact that you actually have to address every starting hand protects PLO for quite a while. I don't think the computing power is to the point to do what it can do in two-card poker. There was also a note on the bet sizing, and I don't think that's very big deal either. There are more bet size options in No Limit by the feature of being able to bet more than the pot, but I don't think betting 1.1x pot, 1.2x pot, 1.3x pot, 1.4x pot, and so on is, I think it's only very slightly marginal than having like a full pot and a 1.5 pot and an all-in size or whatever. I don't think it adds that much value. I hope that made sense. I don't know if I just like went on a rant there about something that people don't follow very closely or understand very well.
I think so. Basically, what he was answering was in terms of the bot being designed by the school. So for many more hand combinations, but bet sizing is more limited, would it be that much more difficult than No Limit? So he's saying, would it be harder or easier to program the bot to have? Actually, I got to read this question a couple fucking times. I'm not sure what's happening in this question right here. So, okay, many more hand combinations, but bet size is more limited. Would it be that much more difficult than No Limit in terms of approaching it at PLO?
Absolutely, yeah.
So basically, because you can bet more than the pot at No Limit, whereas at PLO you can only bet the size of the pot, but there's many more hand combinations, would it be that much more difficult? Which the answer you think is yes.
The hand combinations outweigh the additional bet sizing options greatly.
Yeah, makes sense. So PLO or protected. Well, I don't know. If you read some of the Small Stakes Kilo forums, they're making allegations there might be some bots playing through said Dollar Kilo. So,
yeah. Bots beating Small Stakes is a much more legitimate concern than bots beating High Stakes.
Let's hope so. I mean, I don't know. Kobus could be a bot, man. I don't know. He instantly bets. His graph never goes down. I still think Kobus could be a bot.
Kobus could be a bot, except you said you met him in person, allegedly.
He was allegedly Kobus. It seemed like Kobus to me. I mean, he could have just been saying I'm Kobus, but no one else has ever told me they're Kobus before in person, so I happen to believe him when he mentioned it to me.
You should have Kobus on the podcast. I would enjoy that. I want to see what Kobus is like.
The only scenario I can get Kobus or Ravenswood on a podcast is I have to be in Malta, we have to be drinking, I have to happen to have a webcam or a phone by me, we happen to blow up a live stream, and I got to get them. They got to be drunk. There's no way they'll be doing that sober.
Do you think Kobus does cocaine while he plays?
You know what? That's a great question. I actually asked him that. And that was one of the first questions. And I think he might. I think he might do cocaine when he plays.
I don't think I could play that fast if I wasn't overly stimulated.
I don't know how he does it. Like, he literally bets instantly in situations where it's like, it just shouldn't be possible to be able to bet that fast. I don't know. Yeah. One of the biggest mysteries in the world, my friend. That's one of the biggest mysteries. Fraski says, what about your very successful approach to mastering PLO can help you and others in other fields of life?
Oh, that's a great question.
A great question.
Wow. I got to take a moment to think about that one. One thing that comes to mind instantly is continuing to pursue something like poker that's so challenging has really strengthened my ability and my desire to learn. I could be wrong, but I think a lot of people get out of university and grab a job or get out of high school and grab a job, and then life kind of flattens out, and they work hard, but they don't take on very many new things. They don't try to learn very many new things. They don't really challenge themselves in ways that they aren't already like in the grind of doing every day. And I think that could be a big deal where, say, in 10 years, I don't want to gamble anymore, but my brain is very comfortable and very used to really struggling through learning something that I don't understand. I think it would make a transition into an entirely new thing go smoother and be more more plausible for me. And then, what was the exact wording of the question? Your approach to PLO?
The question was, what about your very successful approach to mastering PLO can help you and others in other fields of life?
Okay. Another small thing that comes to mind that I've always thought was cool is anytime you watch, I like to watch YouTube videos of physicists talking about physics, and some of the most brilliant guys, they have a way of explaining things in such a beautiful, pure, simple form, but their understanding of it is much deeper than everyone else's is, but it's still very elegant and simple. And I think approaching problems in that way where you're trying to just kind of keep the big picture in mind, and I don't have the completion of that thought, but that idea of just seeing that and seeing that in PLO as well, like as I've approached mastering PLO, a lot of really sort of simple sounding concepts have taken on different meanings for me, and my brain would be more receptive of that in a new field and a new undertaking.
So do you feel that you mentioned you're more inclined to want to learn new things because you're actively learning PLO at such a high level? You feel like that sort of carries over into wanting to learn other things? Do you think, is that the way you worded it?
No, not the desire to learn.
The ability to learn?
the first part of my answer or the second part?
Just in terms of the you mentioned about you think the ability to learn has made it's something it's made you want to learn other things more at this current point in time. Whereas when some people get out of college, they sort of just fall into the grind and they're not really as inclined to want to learn new things or pursue new things.
Yeah. Well, so to get where I had in poker, I had to approach a lot of things that I read them and I tried to do the math and I totally didn't get it at all. And then I tried again, totally didn't get it at all. And I worked on that ability to fight through that moment when you're trying to grasp something and your brain wants to quit and give up, and when you're fighting that that blankness that you can't get around the problem and you want to just shut down, I have a lot of practice at fighting through that, which I think I'm totally throwing it out there that this could be true because I don't really know, but I think a lot of people that have a lesser work ethic or lesser desire to be the best at something don't have much of a skill developed in that way, and I think that skill could be powerful for learning something new, whereas if I didn't have it, it would be much more difficult for me to take on something new.
That makes sense. Do you feel like right now that do you feel more motivated to want to learn sort of other things outside of poker, or do you feel like you spend most of your time thinking about just PLO or poker alone?
I love learning other things. Learning is, if I had to write out 5 life principles or something, I'd put learning on there. I think you have to, and especially now with how easy it is. You can learn anything you want with your phone. So I wish I cared more when I was in school. That's something I think about all the time. Like, I spend a lot of time learning about science and physics now, and when I was in school, you couldn't have paid me to pay attention.
Now, I ask that because I've kind of, maybe the past year and a half, I've been sort of like almost obsessed with learning new things. Like, I read constantly. I started playing instruments. I started just doing things I never really thought I would have done, and I think that ability you said before is something I really never put into words, just the ability to sort of keep at it, keep fighting and keep working hard, trying to, like, you know, when you struggle with something, I think your first thought is to just, all right, like, give up or move on to something else. But I think, you know, having success at poker sort of teaches you to keep pushing, keep at it, keep at it, keep at it, keep at it. And I definitely think that's something that's really helped me, you know, learning learning how to play basketball, for instance, is one way it's really helped me, because before basketball, when I suck at some things, I'm just like, ah, fuck, I'll give up. But I just really kept at it. I just kept at it, a very similar path in terms of how I approach poker. And, you know, it's certainly not, you know, where it's, you know, I'm one of the best players in the world of basketball, but it's certainly to a level of success that I never really imagined I'd ever get to at basketball. So I think that ability is something that, you know, I never actually thought about. That's, you know, it's just interesting hearing you word it that way.
Yeah, our brains are incredible. If you keep working at it, eventually, unless it's extremely complicated, maybe it can be out of someone's reach. I'm sure there's things that I can't understand, and everybody has their limits or whatever. But if you keep trying, that cloudiness and that confusion, eventually you get it. Eventually it clicks.
Pretty interesting way to just think about it, though, from that point of view. Fraski asked one more question. Thanks for the questions, by the way, Fraski. What were your most important realizations? This would be an interesting question. What were your most important realizations in terms of mythology of learning? There's a lot of lore.
Methodology?
There's a lot of things after that. What were your most important realizations in terms of methodology of learning? Efficiency, mindset, motivation, collaboration with peers, balancing work and relationship, etc.
Damn.
I know. I was like, I was trying to look at the layer of the question. I'm like, guys, a lot of things in that question, buddy.
I'm sorry. I got to ask you to repeat that.
That's why I read it a couple of times. I was like, God, I'm not sure what he's. Whoa. Let's just start with the first part. What were your most important realizations in terms of methodology of learning, right there. What were your most important realizations in terms of methodology of learning?
That's a good question. I'm okay with that one. Do you want to start there or give the whole dish the whole question out?
I mean, there's efficiency, mindset, motivation, collaboration with peers, balancing work and relationships. So I guess it's a couple different things.
Let's touch on what we can, and if I can't hit all those, I apologize. And also, I think it's important to not repeat the same shit. So I think we've touched on a few of those already, so I'll duck the ones we already talked about. Methodology of learning. This, I think, is huge and not even hard. You have to close the tables and get the books out. That's how I did it. Go get Mathematics of Poker and get lost in that and feel stupid. Maybe it's a little late for that one even. I think a lot of people kind of get the basic concepts there. It's the off-the-table stuff. That's what it is. That's where you fine-tune and really grasp the concepts and the theory, and then you go to work and you put it in play. But separating those two things and dedicating yourself to the off-the-table work is a big deal. It's underrated. It's hard. What were some of the other?
Efficiency, mindset, motivation, collaboration with peers.
Efficiency? I want to say efficiency is rather straightforward. You have as much time, barring your other life obligations. You know, we're all, let's say hypothetically you have 50, 20-something-year-old men or women, and they have the desire to be the best at poker, and their lives are all relatively similar. You have to be efficient with your time, because if you're all equally intelligent and somebody's spending less time playing Dota than you are and more time grinding it out, they're probably going to have an edge on you. Motivation is also a personal thing. One of my main drivers was, as I alluded to earlier, I had a really miserable time in school and that formula where someone tells you what to do and you obey and then you get graded on it. I really hated that, and so one of my great motivators was, let's make a bunch of money on our own so we don't have to do that shit. Motivation is to each their own, though. I couldn't say what would motivate someone else or what would make them bring more efficiency to their efforts. That I feel like you probably know the ways that you're being inefficiently, being inefficient.
I think knowing and executing are slightly two different things when it comes to inefficiency.
Definitely, they're different things, but you don't need my advice on that.
I think a lot of the ideas, you know, it's like the advice you give or the answers you give to some of these questions just gives people something to think about. You know, it gets you into the mind of someone who, you know, you might respect or look up to, or whose word you give a little bit more credibility to than someone else's. And it just gives somebody something new to think about. Maybe they didn't approach it like that. Maybe they've heard someone say it before, but they shook it off. And now they hear you say it and they're like, well, maybe I need to rethink that. And I feel like a lot of the answers to a lot of the ideas or questions or just to some of the things you've said are really going to help some people out there, because I know this is going to be, you know, it's going to be one more popular podcast. And I think we have, you know, right now YouTube's got 315 tracking it live right now. I know YouTube misses a couple of people that aren't logged into the actual system too. So, you know, you're probably going to get a lot of messages. I mean, maybe not a lot. You're probably going to get some messages from people out there who are going to have some good feedback for a lot of the things that you've said or a lot of the advice you've given. So,
yeah, I sincerely hope it's helpful. I really do.
Go ahead.
I just haven't given a lot back to the community, so if little things like this are helpful, that does matter to me. That would make me feel good. Happy to help if I can.
Do you ever, I guess, aspire to want to give more back? And if so, what are some ways you think you could even do that outside of just, you know, strategy-related content specific to poker?
give back specifically to the poker community or give back to humanity or...
Great question, actually. Okay, so let's do both. So poker specific in terms of how you could give back or you feel like you're giving back, and I guess humanity in general, yeah.
Humanity is an easier one. I can collect a lot of resources and then try to distribute them effectively. And that's straightforward. I have access to a lot of money that could do a lot for people that don't have food or water or clothes or something like that. Mm-hmm. Helping out other poker players is tricky. I have a bit of a hang up for helping people in that I want them to be innocent. If you're screwing things up for yourself, I have a very low desire to help you. Which I have a hunch is the case for a lot of poker players that don't do well. In terms of giving back outside of coaching, it's pretty challenging. The questions that we're answering here, the approach, telling people to work on their game off the table, stuff like that, I think those are pretty good ways to do it. I don't know, man. What do you think?
Well, the reason I started doing this podcast was one of the ways I thought about doing it was just in terms of just helping to create some sort of like, you know, something that could be entertaining, something that people could find some inspiration in, potentially become motivated by, just something to really enjoy. Because obviously, like, do you watch any poker content or listen to any poker content or read any poker content right now on a regular basis?
Do I?
Yeah, do you?
Consume any poker content on a regular basis?
Correct. That you really like or really enjoy?
No, I don't believe so. I think the only thing I do is I tune into your show if you're interviewing someone that I like. I watch your Poker Life podcast. I think that's actually it.
That's exactly why I started doing the podcast. And it's obviously it's for a small number of people, but that's why I started doing the podcast. That exact reason was because I wanted guys like me, guys that were out there who play the game for a living. I've said this on numerous podcasts as well in the past, but I want other people my peers that also play the game I love, which is Pot Limit Hold'em, and just poker in general, to be able to have something that they could watch and enjoy. And I just feel like that is sort of my way of giving back to the poker world, just putting something out there that people can.
Yeah.
I have a couple hours to a week or, you know, whatever episode they like to watch, to just enjoy and, like, be entertained.
You also bring people to PLO, which is a great game. It's a fun game. You don't have to play it for a living. You're showing people a game they can go play with their mom on Christmas break or something that they may not have found otherwise. Promoting the game.
Yeah, I definitely enjoy having a lot of the Pot Limit Hold'em guys. Unfortunately, there's not many to have on. A lot of the guys are Swedish. They don't really want to come on. In terms of American guys left, we got, of course, you know, our boy Anski. We got you. We got a guy like Phil. You got Ben Salsky too. What other American guys are still added at the high stakes world who are active? Or I guess Whiteline plays heads up mainly, but he's pretty active too.
You want specifically American guys? There's Ike. Ike hasn't been on, right?
Oh, we're getting Hollywood's coming on. He said he's interested in coming on. We're getting Hollywood on.
He might be too big time. He did Joe Rogan, right?
That's what I said. People were like, people were like, we need Hollywood Hexen on. I was like, he just did Joe Rogan's podcast. Like, I mean, you know, I feel embarrassed almost having him on the podcast after he does Joe Rogan's podcast. That's a big time podcast right there.
Ike's a superstar.
That's why his name's Hollywood Hexen, baby.
Who else is an American nosebleeder?
This is where the chat would pay off if I had it open, but unfortunately I don't have it open. Yeah,
people would love to hear from Dong. Have you had Donger on?
Yeah, I had. Who was that?
Dong? BDD?
Oh, Big Dick Donger. Yeah, I know Big Dick Donger Kim. Yeah, I had Donger Kim on a podcast, yes.
I don't know who else. I'm sure there's a handful that you could come up with.
Yeah, we got to get – I want my goal is to get every single PLO player 5, 10, and plus regular on the podcast at some point in time. Bam. I'm going to go recruit during the World Series of Poker and try to get all those Finnish and Norwegian guys on too that I haven't met quite yet in real life. Shout out to Mr. Ubeen. Shout out to Vroom. I'm going to get you motherfuckers on podcast. I promise you, you guys are coming on. I know they're excited. Come on. Mr. Ubeen wants to come on. We're definitely getting him on. But yeah, what was the – there was one good question. I guess I will ask you this too because I'm just curious what you think. Do you have any sort of rankings list for the six max games in particular at the Zoom?
Sure. I'll do top four.
Okay.
Sauce 123, MOP, Ike Haxton, Ben 86.
What about for the Northern European guys? Who would you rank as one of the top players from the Northern European countries, the Swede, Norway / Finland group?
I think Room is playing well right now. I think Supernova 9 was my five. I feel I should. He deserves a note there. Of Northern Europe, it's Room. Barry plays okay.
Bang bang. Barry's gonna be pissed right now. I know, man. He's gonna be like, "Motherfucker, so I play okay, huh?"
I feel like I'm saying too much. Sincerely, those guys are all very close. Barry, Johan, Jedi Master, they're tough and they play a little bit similar, and I would have a hard time ordering them from best to worst. Was that not satisfactory?
No, that was good. I just can't wait to talk to Barry and Finn and see what his dad has to say about that. He'll probably admit, like, yeah, good point.
We just approach poker differently in that Barry is going hard on exploitation, and he's doing really well at it, but it looks ridiculous in a bunch of spots. I think that's all it is.
Me and Barry were talking about a term called backdoor blockers. Do you ever implement backdoor blockers into your plan, your gameplay?
Absolutely.
I'm not actually going to talk about that. Never mind. Me and Barry have been talking about it, and I was like, at first I thought it was like a trolling idea, but then I was like, God damn, that's actually it makes sense. He definitely takes backdoor blockers into your account in terms of especially as stacks get deeper.
It's important. No blocker should be forgotten. That's a simple, elegant thing about PLO. You have four cards, and you should use all of them. They all have something to offer.
Do you ever use the term hardcore blocker?
The hardcore blocker?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not familiar with it. I'm trying to guess what that would mean. Does it block two things at once?
We use it as referencing. So if you have the four spades, that would be considered a hardcore blocker.
Like you're just grasping at something to block.
Pretty much, yeah. Like you, when you have four spades on three flush board, the four spades is a hardcore blocker. So you have a hardcore block. It might be on like a four card board, a four spade board, and you have a low spade in your hand. That's like a hardcore blocker. But I don't actually know. Barry also said he uses hardcore blockers quite freely as well too. So, and I feel like I'm giving a lot of strategy away now. And this is why he's the top winner according to Russian PTR. So,
there's no secret that when there's four spades on the board, and you have a spade in your hand but not two, that's a better hand to bluff with than when you don't have a spade. It doesn't matter if it's the four or the ten. If you're categorizing bluffs, you're most likely going to want to have a spade. I don't think you're giving too much away there.
Hardcore blockers. Would you rather in the boxing ring? Would you rather box Anski or would you rather box Lottie?
Lottie.
Why would you rather box Lottie?
I think deep down Donnie's a pacifist, and I wouldn't want to fight a I wouldn't want to fight someone who's got a... Well, he's my friend, too. And Lottie plays kind of like he needs a... I'm gonna hold my tongue on that one.
Have you seen Lottie on the podcast, by any chance?
No, was he on?
Yeah, he came on before, yeah.
Holy shit. He just plays real crazy.
Yes, he does.
I actually don't play with him often.
Would you rather have Illyri at your party or Illyri at your poker table?
Party. 100%.
I see that. Reverse, what are your favorite blockers? Reverse blockers or backdoor blockers?
I kind of like to treat all blockers equally. I don't like to leave any blockers out. If I had to choose, probably backdoor blockers.
Backdoor blockers are awesome. All right, those three were the very questions I told you about earlier that he had for me, that he had to ask. I think he had those in general. I don't necessarily know if they were opponent specific for you, but
well done. Those were good questions, Barry.
Thank you, Barry. Shout out to Barry, by the way, Mr. Anonymous, the anonymous suite. Another question I came up with today, which is kind of like an interesting idea, is what are some of your challenges in poker now, or what have some of your challenges been in poker?
A big challenge for me right now is to deal with stress properly. I don't physically feel very irritated when I play. If I, the other night against Victor, for instance, I immediately won 200K and then I lost 500 and I was stuck 300 and I didn't feel bad. I knew what was happening and it doesn't feel good, but I wasn't clinching or yelling or slamming my fist on my desk. But all of the next week, a stomach ulcer that I'd been dealing with started to act up again. So I think what's happening is I've learned to absorb it and objectively continued to go to work, but I'm internalizing the stress in an unhealthy way. That's a huge challenge for me right now. Ulcers are terrible, and I would like to be able to handle the swings and all the other stress that goes into doing what we do.
How do you get better at doing something like that, though?
I think a lot of the simple things are important, like drinking enough water, getting enough sleep, breathing. I have a bad tendency to hold my breath when I play poker. I think I like to hold my breath when I'm thinking really hard. And so if I'm playing an intense heads-up match, there's all these periods where I'm actually not breathing. And I think that's really bad for your body. I think being efficient in the time when you're not playing poker to make sure you're getting good nutrition and getting enough fluids in your body and going for a run and lying down and stretching and stuff like that. I think it all ties together.
Do you feel like you can improve in a lot of those categories in terms of when it comes to reducing the stress?
Sorry, could you repeat that?
I said, do you feel like you could be improving a lot of those areas to better help you to be reducing your stress that you have right now with all the swings that come along with it?
I think I have tremendous room for improvement in all of those categories. I've worked with this a lot, and I'm a pretty big believer that you've got half of your brain that's sort of your analytical fight or flight think mode, and then you've got another side of your brain that controls your rest, regeneration, all the bodily functions that you perform innately, like what's an example of one of them? Like sometimes, for example, I'll play a long session, and I'll feel kind of amped up. And if I go lie on the floor and just start breathing, I might yawn like 15 times. So I'm actually really tired. And my once I relax and let that system in my body dominate a little bit, it knows that like you're really tired. Let's breathe and yawn, and my eyes will start watering and stuff, and everything will kind of soften. And I think there's a skill in being able to kind of balance the two sides and allow, like if you're out on a date, I think you want that restful side to be engaged more. And when you're playing poker, I think you want to be in full adrenaline mode. So learning the balance there, learning to use both sides.
What about in terms of regular life? I guess maybe the things kind of correlate with each other. Maybe the challenges you face in poker are also challenges that you face in your life as well. You'd consider them one and the same.
How do you mean?
So let's say that you're challenged in poker, for instance, you're trying to reduce your stress, you're trying to figure out a way to better manage your stress. Well, that also, when you just, let's say you just look at your life in general, you say, what are my challenges in life right now? Maybe you'd consider reducing your stress as one of your biggest challenges in your overall life, not just that might be poker specific.
Absolutely, yeah. There's definitely things that cross over. Perfectionism is a big one. I'm super hard on myself if I do something wrong, or like in poker, if I misplay a hand, it's just absolutely day-ruining if I brutally misplay a hand. And then a representative situation outside of poker, if I go try to talk to a girl on the street or something, and I just, like, I don't know, do something dumb, like, I'm sure everyone who's walked up to a girl on the street and tried to talk to her has probably done something dumb before. And if you can't laugh at that and kind of let it go, you're going to have a really hard time getting any better at what you're doing. Being less hard on myself in both areas would be a huge improvement.
Let's say you're walking the street of Cole Harbour, you're in Vancouver, you're going to go up talk to a girl. What are you saying to her? What's the strategy? What are you thinking? What do you say?
Yeah, well, ideally, There's the way that it should happen and the way that it often does happen, and they're two very different things. The way that it should happen is you see the girl and you notice something about her, and you walk over and you tell her the genuine thing that was in your head, and it's authentic and you really mean it, and she knows you mean it. And whether you introduce yourself or however it goes from there, or whatever ordering you said things, doesn't really matter. Women have an amazing filter, I've learned, that they can tell if you're for real, and they can tell if you're full of shit. And if you have this genuine comment and you go say it to her, I find more often times than not, it's received very well. The other way that can look is you had the comment, you wanted to say it to her, but you got nervous, and then you kind of thought, like, oh shit, I'm supposed to go talk to her, I'm messing up right now. And then you're replaying the comment and now it doesn't sound so great. And then you walk over and you force it out and she looks at you like, wait, what's the matter with this guy? This guy's weird. That's the first way is the way I would like to do it, and the second way is unfortunately a way that it often happens, if I'm being honest. And those don't often go well.
I kind of like that approach of commenting on something. For instance, if you saw me walking the street, you'd be like, "Oh, I really like the way your hair sits in that headband." I'd be like, "Oh shit, what's up, man? All right, that's cool."
Yeah, man. As long as you mean it, I think that's the key.
It's like my approach to it was just like, "What's going on? Hey, I mean, I say hi. I don't know. I say hi and I smile. Usually that works out pretty well for me." But I like the idea of, it's sort of like an online dating strategy where when you're reading a girl's profile, you pick something out that's interesting, and then you ask some online dating GTO guys, grab your notebooks, all my online daters out there. but you read their profile, you see something that you can relate to, or in theory you relate to. Obviously, sometimes you make up what you relate to, and then you point it out in the profile. I guess it's the same. If you see a girl and you see she's wearing a nice headband, maybe you, the way you like the way her hair's sitting in the headband, then you're like, "What's up?"
Yeah.
I like the way. I'm like, "Damn, girl." Well, never mind.
Walking up and saying hi is, I think, absolutely fine too. But yeah, ideally you'd have something to, something that's unique to them, I think, is a nice way to do it rather than a total generic approach.
I'm gonna run some sims on this idea, Ben. I'm gonna try to sim in this idea out lately and see. I really like the way. I'm gonna brainstorm ideas later on things I could say to people, but I guess I have to actually genuinely
like about it.
I feel like Vancouver is such a great place to go just talk to random people. There's just so many people. There's so many different ethnicities. There's so many different types of, you know, what people do for a living and what their aspirations are, what their hobbies are. Like, you can literally meet someone that just enjoys doing all kind of pretty cool things in Vancouver.
Especially right now, man. It's beautiful outside every day. Everybody's all happy.
Yeah. And the nude beach is a great place to go. Obviously, there. When you think about a nude beach, you think about like fat dudes with like, you know, their dicks out and like ugly. Ugly is a strong word, but maybe not attractive girls with their boobs out. But actually, I know a lot of girls that go there who are very attractive and they enjoy taking off their clothes there. So if you're in Vancouver, you should check out Wreck Beach.
Yeah,
but watch out for the stairs because. You're going to puke on your way coming up from the stairs.
Is it bad out there?
The stairs are some of the, yeah, they're terrible to climb up and down. Yeah.
I can't tell if you're just, are you just saying there's a lot of undesirable people congregating near the stairs?
No, I literally threw up on the stairs walking up them. I threw up on the way up.
Why?
That's a great question. Well, I was playing some chess down at the beach with a woman that day, and she may or may not have embraced the idea of Wreck Beach. And I guess I was a little tired on the way up from the stairs. I got so fatigued. I guess I was out of shape. I was grinding supernovae at the time, so I couldn't be bothered to stay in that. I guess I was in okay shape, but yeah, I definitely threw up.
Damn. I thought you were making some kind of joke. You actually just puked on the stairs. That's kind
of... I'm telling you, these stairs are fucking brutal, man. There's a lot of stairs. I'm not exaggerating. This is a lot of stairs. Like, a lot of stairs. This isn't a troll. It's a lot of stairs. I'm getting a little bit worried even thinking about the stairs. All right, I'm gonna load up the chat because I'm gonna take a couple questions from the chat.
All right.
And then we're gonna wrap things up in a little bit.
All right, I'm gonna run to the toilet. I'll be right back.
Okay. Normally, guys, I'd give a couple shout-outs right now, but unfortunately, I don't have the chat open. I apologize, chat. I feel like I've neglected you. You guys are always there. You guys are always hanging out. I apologize, chat. I'm sorry. I've missed you, honestly. Sarah, I've missed you. I hope you're out there. Tim Stone, I hope you're there. AJ, I still hope you're still there. Tim F, I hope you're still there. Escobar, I hope you're still here. Vincent Vega, I look like a porn star. Thank you. I appreciate that. Versace, what's up, Versace? Adam Heath, when are you coming to Toronto? We can play ball. I'm not sure when I'm going to Toronto, but all I know is if I go to Toronto, I'm going to give you that work, son. You can play ball with me in Vegas, though. I'm taking on all comers. Let's see. Hi, guys. No scoop for Ben. Go see Obama. What's up? Mickey, what's up? Sean Skinner, what's up? Marcus Legit, Tim F. Puppy, Snyder X, what's up, boys? I feel like I'm back, man. A part of me is here right now. This is amazing. Sarah DiMaggio. I hope you make a last-minute trip to Mystery Land and play. Sarah, if I go to Mystery Land, you know what it is. Show of Force, what's up? Tim S. Rems, M1 User, Puppy, Piston Honda, what's up? Trade by Day, what's up? Tempest, wait, Christian? Okay. LL1, what's up? AJ, CG, shout out Poppy and Ben. Check out my questions on 2+2. CG, I'll check them out. Deep House, what's up, Deep House? Ben Hellstrip, what's up? Steven Jones, what's up, Steven? Sick podcast. Yo, Steven, much love, man. I hope it's the Steven I'm thinking about. Shout out to you. Shout out to your wife. Hope you guys are doing well. Hope that live poker grind in Chicago is treating you well, my friend. Ben, welcome back, my friend. To a podcast guest, a sick podcast guest. I agree. One of the best. I agree. CG, awesome. What's going on?
Thanks for that. That's nice to hear.
Oh, yeah, man. A lot of love in the chat right now. A lot of love. Daniel T, what's up, puppy? I think CG has some questions. Let's see. CG says, let me chat about that. Ask about drunken workouts.
Did drunk workouts the thing I do for therapy?
What?
Who asked that question? Did you say CTS asked it?
No, CG asked it.
Oh, Chris. What's up, Chris? I can't even. I do drunk workouts for therapeutic reasons, but I've tried to explain it to like 3 people, and I suck at explaining it. I purchased the science behind it from a PhD student in physiology, kinesiology, biology, whichever one it is, and I totally buy it. But I'm not gonna try to replicate that and have a bunch of people go get hurt. Don't drink while you work out.
Yeah, seems like not a GTO way to approach working out, my friend.
It's not like I'm going and cranking out deadlifts and stuff. It's you loosen up and get the pain relieving effect, and then you go stretch and do medicine ball exercises and work on your rotator cuff and stuff like that. It's very mild, very gentle. Get in like squat form and just kind of like walk around and move around and go through the range of motion while you're inebriated. It's for it's a muscle recruitment thing. If anybody's really interested, we shouldn't. That's all. Don't worry about that one.
Well, to be fair, it's also quite good to do yoga and psychedelics. Just to say, I mean, if anyone's interested in that as well. You should really try stretching. You'd be amazed at what your body could do when you're on a psychedelic that tranquilizes your body.
It's like peanut butter and jelly.
It kind of goes well together. I agree. Delete TV says, Ben looks like a Tour de France guy.
What does that mean?
I guess you look like a bike rider.
All right. What is that? I want to know more. What does that mean?
Really good question. Dion asks, has Ben dabbled in psychedelics before?
Not as much as I'd like, but I have dabbled. I'm not sure how much I'm supposed to say about that.
Yeah, those are against TOS sometimes.
I mean, I don't care. I've done mushrooms before. I'm very curious, but find them hard to acquire without taking on some risk that I'm not willing to take on.
I've yet to try those before. I don't think I have. I'd like to try those at some point in time when I unretire from that point in my life.
What have you tried? Feel free to deflect if you're not comfortable.
Let's see. I think I've tried the two. Well, they're two main drugs to me, but not main to everyone. So MDMA and ketamine are the two drugs that I've tried before in my life.
Okay.
Both very enjoyable and both very enjoyable things for sure. Definitely, I've tried weed before, although there has been a bad influence in my life, Brian Hastings, who's tried to get me to do it, and I've said no. But sorry, Brian. But yeah, have you ever tried that before? It seems like a lot. I mean, every poker player pretty much smokes weed. It feels like.
Yeah, I think weed's great.
Yeah, Vancouver, it flows quite freely. Everyone in Vancouver loves to smoke weed.
Yeah, it does.
I'm not even sure it's illegal in Mushroom. I'm not even sure it's illegal in Vancouver because it just seems like literally everyone's done it.
It's a soft kind of illegal where it's not enforced.
It's true. People are funny in the chat. They're saying, you haven't done weed, but you've done. Okay. You know, it's an interesting time in my life, man. Honestly, I think drugs are really all about who you meet. If you happen to meet the right group of people who you trust or you have fun with or that are into that sort of stuff and then they recommend you try it, then, you know, sometimes things happen. And, yeah.
I enjoy the range of shit that you get in the chat. You have like the real poker questions. You have the people that are kind of screwing around. You've got the podcast pro guys. And then you have this small section of people that just type absurdities in the midst of everything.
It's a great mix. Usually it's a lot of the same people. So like a lot of people that are here in the chat right now pretty much come to they come to far too many live streams than I never would expect anyone to ever come to. So they definitely provide for a very great community of people, and it's certainly one of the exciting things about doing podcast is that you get a lot of these cool people. Obviously with Twitch, I don't think we're going to be seeing you stream on Twitch anytime soon, are we?
What's that about Twitch?
Are you going to be streaming on Twitch anytime soon?
Oh, no. No, I can't. There's no value in it. If PokerStars wants another American Nosebleed Pro, I'd consider it, but I wouldn't do it just for the hell of it.
which comment did you read?
Goats Obama. he knows his role in chat, and he appreciated the show.
Yeah, Goats Obama is certainly one of the he's certainly one of the more interesting commenters for sure. Pierre asks, how often are you doing the podcast? I do the podcast. There's no set schedule. I'm doing another podcast on Monday with Jason Somerville, a.k.a. Jay Carver, the end boss of Twitch, the man himself, Jason Somerville, 4 p.m. Eastern, next Monday. I'm excited for that. Are you familiar with Jason at all?
Yep. Very, very kind person from my interactions with him. I'm a big fan.
Same, definitely. I'm very excited to have him on. I'm very pumped up. We'll ask one of my usual questions, which I always enjoy asking. If you had to recommend two podcast guests for me to have on in the future that you would like to see, that you think would be interested in coming on, who would you recommend?
Two podcast guests. I'd like to hear from Kobus and Yorubu.
Well, I can tell you Kobus or Yorubu probably aren't coming on anytime soon. So let's pick two people who might have a chance to get on. Kobus isn't going to come on.
Those aren't realistic enough?
Okay. No, I don't think he's going to come on. And Yorubu won't come on. I've asked Yorubu once or twice, but I kind of give up asking him now.
Who else is a fascinating person in the PLO world? You've had a lot of the heavy hitters on already.
I know. I'm trying to save a couple for later. There's one American person I'm saving at some point in time, but I'm going to have them on.
One you're saving.
I can't blow my load all the way too soon and have all the end bosses on right away, and then we got no one else left to have come on. We set the bar too high.
Fair enough.
Bong Bob.
Maybe one of the guys that gets into the absurd live games would be cool to hear from. To just kind of hear those stories and what an average night looks like when you go play some nosebleed private game. Maybe one of the guys in Central Europe, like, I think Benny Spindler plays those games. He might have some interesting stuff to talk about.
An idea.
Who else plays those live Nosebleeds games? Jeans, maybe? I'd love to hear Jeans' podcast if you could get Jeans to come on. Yeah, I'll go with Jeans and Benny, and if you couldn't get Benny, someone else that's in that circle where we could hear what that's like. I don't really know much about that.
You just gave me another goal for the summer. Seek out all the Central European guys and, get to talk to them more. Couple suggestions. Action Freak. I actually have to ask Action Freak. He'd be interested in coming on one day. A lot of those guys, I think I just have to meet in person and then convince them in person to come on. Or just ask him in person. Because a lot of times you're like, you know, you're like cold calling them on Twitter. You're like a telemarketer. Like, hey, I do a podcast, interested in coming on, you know, and then it's just like you don't really have any personal interaction with them. And I think most people just are like, nah, I don't think so. Like podcasts, I think most poker podcasts, people think about a poker podcast, they think about the same old sort of same old. So
yeah, there's a little bit of a barrier there. I think guys that have watched the show would be more likely to come on it.
For sure. Chris at, or CG said, Brian Hastings. I've had Sting around before. I'm gonna have Brian on again very soon. Brian is obviously one of my good friends, and I would love having Brian on. Alex says, Ben, how long do you think Melvin Holden will still be profitable online?
Is that a question of when do the bots take over, or what exactly is he going for there?
I feel like he's just asking in general, how often, how much longer do you think online will still be profitable?
Oh my God, I want to revise my previous answer. I want Jeans and I want Will Hasha. That's who I want.
Will Hasha, huh?
Please get Will Hasha on. I'd be glued to my computer.
I believe I have a friend who's actually friends with Will Hasha in real life, so.
Please make it happen.
I could certainly ask him and find out.
That'd be terrific. How much longer will NL be profitable? If you're okay, I don't know what you consider profitable. High stakes NL, I think, has a couple of years left. Maybe 2 to 3 years.
What about... Sweet headband. I know. What about lower stakes NL, potentially? The 2, 4 to 5, 10, 10, 20 games?
It would be this weird area where it would be beatable, but the guys that were good enough to beat it probably have too much money to care about beating it.
That makes sense. What do you think about PLO games in terms of the 10-20 Zoom, 20-50 Zoom?
I think we're good for a long time. PLO is such a wonderful fish game, an action game, a game where people will go on heaters. Being the worst player at the table in PLO is not even in the same league of brutality as being the worst player at an NL table. You can still have a great time being terrible at PLO at a six-handed table. I imagine being bad at six-handed no limit, you just never win a pot. I bet it's miserable.
Yeah, I mean, that's the joy of PLO, is that you could be playing, you know, 55% of your hands as a fun player, and you could be winning a large majority of your hands as a fun player. You could even be winning a couple sessions.
You can just, like, cold four bet anything and do okay. It's an awesome game it's a terrific substitute for craps.
What do you bet when you play craps?
I don't play in the pit.
Okay, good. I haven't gambled in the pit in, like, 5 years or something like that. God, I sound like it's such a nit, but yeah, I don't really gamble. I rarely sports bet.
If you think it's incredibly fun and you won't do it, then you're a nit. But I don't see... I would much rather go play Settlers than go throw dice at a table in a casino in Vegas. It's just not... I don't think it's fun at all.
I definitely agree. I'm starting to yawn. I've been awake for, like, I don't even know when I last slept, to be honest with you. I'm sleeping so terribly in this hotel room. I don't have a fan here. I haven't been sleeping with headphones. I have some un-GTO sleeping pills I've been trying to take to help, but yeah, going through the sleep, yeah, man, it's not good for your, I mean, I can't imagine doing it and playing at the high level you're playing at. Like, I feel like the more tired you are, just hurts your overall thought process, your overall mindset that much more. And I can't even imagine being slightly tired, but trying to process at that high level. It just seems like it would be incredibly hard to do.
It's real challenging. I've been sitting out a lot lately because I'm too tired and not healthy right now.
It's crazy. I mean, I guess you're not sitting out as other, obviously, but do you, you know, how are you hoping to fix it? Are you just hoping to be able to try to sleep more, or?
I think there's plenty of straightforward things I can do. Fix the lighting in the room. potentially take some sleeping pills for a short period of time as a crutch to get back in a good rhythm, be better about caffeine. I think there's a lot of things that if I just were more attentive to it, it would be less of a problem.
Yeah, that makes sense. Somebody said my face looks red. First of all, my face isn't red. It's the lighting in the room. Although maybe it is red. I don't know. It's the lighting for sure, though.
You're in San Diego?
Yeah, I'm in San Diego. I'm not sunburned. I promise my face. Maybe my face is red. It's the lighting. I don't know, man. I don't think it's that red. And someone said high blood pressure. Shit, man. Maybe we both got high blood pressure. Who knows? The Karate Kid. Oh my god, the chat. I can't look at the chat anymore. Y'all tripping me out right now. Look at the Karate fucking Kid. Let me put my hair in a ponytail right here. I'll really look like the samurai. Ben, you have anything else you'd like to talk about, add, or ask me, potentially, here as we end our journey today?
I think I've said plenty. I'm talked out, but to ask you, how serious are you about hitting SNE from zero in the second half of this year?
If I relocate, I will hit Supernova Elite 100%. Why do you ask?
I enjoy watching those kind of stick grind challenges, and I know it's not that bad, Supernova Elite in half a year. We were just chatting about it the other day, and I was curious how, if you really meant it, or if it was sort of just an idea.
Yeah, I've been thinking about going back to Vancouver, but I just really enjoy the United States. You know, I just really enjoy the United States. Honestly, I have a lot of anxiety about leaving the country again. That's basically what the biggest reason is. I'm not sure why. Like, I probably shouldn't have any anxiety about it, to be honest with you. But I just really have some super bad anxiety, and I'm going to a music festival in July in Belgium, and you know, I might just stay over there for like who knows when. I might just literally stay there for a prolonged period of time. Cool. So, yeah, I'm not sure. That's basically what the biggest hurdle is just the anxiety I have about leaving the country, which is seemingly really weird, but yeah, that's pretty much what the reason is right now.
Do you mean stay in Belgium or stay in Europe and travel around?
I'd go to Malta for sure. There's just so many people in Malta. Like, I mean, obviously Kovas and Ravens that are there. But Herman is there. I think Jay Nandez stays in Switzerland or Malta. I think he might go back in between and forth. I mean, there's just such a huge contingency of poker players that live in Malta that would be the place I would go to for sure.
One other thing that I'm curious about, who's your dream podcast guest?
The dream podcast guest? That's a great question. The dream podcast guest? What do you say?
It's your last night. You're hanging the show up after hundreds of episodes. Who do you want to go out with?
This is in terms of poker world, correct?
Yeah.
Oh, well, I would say Isildur, but I think he'd just be boring.
I don't think I'd be very good.
Yeah, I think Isildur would be boring. I think I'll be able to get Illyri on. I think I'll be able to get Illyri on before the end of this year. So I don't think he could be a dream podcast guest. The dream podcast guest.
I just saw a Kappa in the YouTube chat.
You saw what? Oh yeah, I know. Okay, yeah, I know. It's I mean, I guess if Phil Ivey was very open, I mean, about his answers, I guess it would either be Phil Ivey or like if I could get him on for like an hour or two and have an actual discussion. I mean, I'd love to have Durr on just because I think that would be just the questions I could ask and his answers. Like, I mean, like, yeah, but like, I just can't like talk about it. You know, I just think his answers would be, I guess it would have to be like Phil Ivey, Durr, or Illyri. I think Illyri is probably like one of the ultimate guests to have on.
Illyri would be hilarious. Ivey would be interesting and Durr would be intolerable.
What do you think Durr would be intolerable? Because he wouldn't give answers to questions?
I don't think he'd answer any of your questions. It would be like a politician dodging thing. It'd just be annoying.
Yeah, I could see that. Some people said Viffer, too. I guess Viffer would be really, really fucking fun. See, Viffer's the only person I think I could actually have on. Like, a lot of these people, if I talk to him during World Series of Poker, I think I can get him to come on.
Probably.
Bipper would be really fun to have on, though. We'll leave with a Hollywood Haxton impression. Do you have a Hollywood Haxton impression for us?
Not that one doesn't come to me. And hate to disappoint, but no, I don't think I've got an Ike impression in there.
All right, I haven't done an Ike impression in a minute. I'm gonna give it a shot. All right, hold on. I need my glasses. The shoulders are up. The shoulders are up. All right, guys. Man, I can't. I gotta study his voice again. Like, I think that I really like Joey's podcast, but the Dream Machine. He's been talking about me having the Dream Machine. I got it. I got the shoulders and the face down. I need the glasses down, obviously, but I've got to go study his voice. He talked about the podcast and the Dream Machine on a recent live stream. So,
what's a Dream Machine?
A Dream Machine is Ike Haxton's machine that he has for PLO, which he just plugs in numbers and it gives him the answer to every situation in PLO, and that's how he's allegedly got so good at PLO.
Oh, sick.
Ben is Hollywood Haxton's twin.
I would take that as a huge compliment.
I would take that as a huge compliment too. So, all right, guys, we're gonna wrap up the chat. Thank you guys for the questions. Thank you for the comments. Thank you for all the feedback. Let me know what you thought about the podcast. You can post it on 2+2 in the thread. You can post it on Twitter, on Facebook. If you want to hit up Ben, BTTECH86 on Twitter.
That's right, yeah, BTTech86.
If you, for some reason, want to send Ben a message, tell him how much you thought about his podcast appearance, you can send a message on 2+2. You're Ben86 on 2+2, correct?
That's right.
If you have any questions, comments for him, feel free, hit him up. Any for me, feel free, get in touch with me. Should be back on Monday, Jay Sardle, Jay Carver, 4 p.m. Eastern. Might be doing some live streams of 200, 400 over the weekend. While the deep banning's been running, are you going to be trying to play in those games, Ben, if those run?
If I'm feeling better, I will. And if I'm still not feeling great, I'll sit out.
Well, Ben, we hope to see you in the games. We hope to give you a sweat. We hope the podcast run good, pays off for you, and you continue to make more and more money and continued success, my friend.
Awesome.
All right.
Thanks for having me on. Thanks for all the questions, guys. Hope you enjoyed it.
I think they very much enjoyed it, my friend. It's been a great time, guys. Peace out. Be back soon.
I'm out. Take care, buddy.